Well, good morning, everyone. We are picking up on H.107. We have an interesting mix of witnesses this morning. We'll start with Commissioner Curley and with Heckwood, who is with the department. But first, let's once again go around the room for introductions. We'll start with the committee, and then I'd like to just go around the room. There's a lot of people in here today. Most faces I recognize and some I don't. So I'd just like to know who's here and who you're representing, if you wanted to share that. So Tom Stevens from Waterbury. I represent Waterbury and Moulton, Huntington, and Buell Score. Representative Gonzalez is a ranking member. She's from Winooski. She won't be in today.
Matt Byron, Virgens, representing Virgens, Ferrisburg, Hanton, Waltham, and Edison.
Randall Zott from Barnard.
Mariana Gamash from Swanton.
John Kalacki from South Burlington.
Tommy Waltz from Barry City.
Chip Troiano, representing Hardwood Standard in Walden, Northeast Kingdom.
And Representative Howard from Rutland is also in the committee. She has broken her arm in two places this week. And Representative Long from Newfane is will be in if she can make it. And then we have a vacancy.
Ed Doten, Action Circle's legislative intern.
Doug Farnham, Tax Department.
Damian Leonard, Legislative Council.
Joyce Manchester, Joint Fiscal Office.
Kelly Avery, Vermont Cities and Towns.
Dirk Anderson, General Counsel, Department of Labor.
Jessica Jingras, I'm the Legislative Policy Director for the Department of Labor.
Angela Earlway, I'm Director of Human Resources for Climate Technology.
Ashley Moore of the Main Street Alliance in Vermont.
Dennis LeBounty, Vermont AFL-CIO.
Bill Beacom, I'm with Jones, Rockland Martin.
Matt McMahon with MMR.
Tess Kennedy, Scholes Associates.
Great. Welcome, everybody. And are you from Orca?
Jerome Lucani.
So we invited you back in, Commissioner, and your team to really walk us through your thoughts on the bill. Over the years, there's been some evolution on thoughts about the bill. And while we acknowledge that there's a, we had the administration in yesterday as well to discuss the administration's plan, we just wanted to hear from the Department of Labor on the practicality. This is a system that would probably be housed, half of the computers would probably be housed in the Department of Labor and half in tax. And we just wanted to get your thoughts and Cameron's thoughts, obviously, on the practicality of what we're looking to do and how it is to set up a program that is similar to programs we already have. But I must say, after doing my expenses on the new employee expense computer program, I understand that things can be difficult rolling out. The microphone is yours.
Thank you. For the record, I'm Lindsay Curley, the Commissioner of Labor, and with me today...
Cameron Wood. I am the, Director of the Unemployment Insurance Division for the Department of Labor.
And we'll also squeeze Dirk up to the table here in a little bit, if that's okay. I'll just kind of start off, and then I'll make room, because they're the experts. So.
Sure. And in a case like today, especially with the department, anybody, when we get going, on occasion, someone may raise their hand from the sides. We try to keep the witnesses here at the microphone, but if I do notice that somebody is offering information that can clarify a point, just please, if I recognize you, please identify yourself so that when this is on the record, we know who's chatting.
Sure. So as you mentioned, I know yesterday Kendall Smith, along with Commissioners Pichek and Fastigi, were here to talk about the proposal by the administration with the state of New Hampshire. And we are really here today to, I'll just reiterate, obviously we are also reminding you that we do not support a mandatory paid family leave program. That being said, you're here to talk about H-107 and... we want to really focus on that for you all today, and regardless of what the administration's proposal is, we're going to talk about H-107, separate from that, because we do have some things that we want you all to really think about as you move forward in making your decisions. I understand yesterday that you asked that the administration be very responsive and thorough as the committee makes requests, and I just want you to know that our team is, we are fully on board with that, and we are committed to doing so. I just want to give a little outline, and like I said, then hand it over to Director Wood and General Counsel Anderson, because they both have a great deal of expertise with respect to our unemployment insurance program, which is really the only thing, or the closest thing, that we can compare to this, so we can talk as experts from that perspective to help through this process. The bill as proposed, as I understand it, would require the Department of Labor to do the following: administer the receipt and processing of benefit applications, create forms, processes, create and adopt rules, determine eligibility for the benefits, and make that determination no later than 5 business days after a claim is filed. The maximum time allotted is 10 days. We would be responsible for collecting overpaid benefits. We would be responsible for creating the ability and capacity to determine an audit process in an effort to reduce false statements and representations. We would create an appeals process, developing and making information available and materials to educate employers and employees regarding the program. We would report to the General Assembly every year the contribution rate necessary to provide the benefits and administer the program, and assume all other duties that are not specifically laid out in the bill to be covered by the tax department, who would be co-administering as we understand. The largest and most concerning piece of the bill and this program for our department is a perceived lack of understanding regarding the funding needed to create and carry out such a program. There were some preliminary numbers discussed at the very tail end of last biennium, which we'd be happy to try and go over for that. As you know, again, we did testify a great deal last year on this, a little bit in this committee, but quite a bit in the Senate as well. And, you know, what we feel is really important is that if we are doing this, we have to have a properly built IT system. We have to have the infrastructure in place to have this case management system and to track the claims and track determination, basically track everything that we need to track through this process. And another piece of it is tracking determinations as to whether or not claimants fit the medical criteria or are even eligible. At some point last year, there was some suggestion that maybe we could just hire people and do a very manual approach. And I just want to caution you all that based on what I know now and watching our unemployment insurance program try to come into a modernized program, IT system, we don't want anything that manual. So I would hope that we could keep that off the table. But again, our concern is that we know how much it's taken for us to lift an IT system that is in a consortium, meaning it's built, another state is helping us to build the system, which means the costs are kept down. But we're looking at, right now, we've spent $20 million to lift our UI system. And in talking with the state that we're involved in, if everybody had it to do it over, we would all say that we should have put more money aside for it, or we would have put more money aside. That being said, we have an agreement with them. We're working through it. But sometimes when I hear, you know, like $2 million thrown out for a system, it puts me into a anxiety, I guess. So I just want us to be thoughtful as we go through and understand what the cost behind building a system like this is. Again, I don't want to delay. I want to let you all chat with Cameron because he really is the expert, as well as Dirk. But I'll stay here and be available for questions as needed.
Great. Thank you.
I'm going to shift to the side. Dirk, do you want to
come up here? Before we get, may I ask?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Three of us are freshmen, and many others are new to this committee. And so I think those costs, the IT costs that you came up with at the end of last session, would be
helpful to
of note for okay. us. So if you could share those with us at some point, I think that would be helpful.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah.
Okay. So
Cameron might
speak to that.
Yeah, he might have that in his notes for today as well. Yeah, I appreciate you saying that. That's very helpful. Anyone else?
Yes.
I'm Angela Earl Gray. I'm from Chroma Technology. I'm actually just curious, have you looked at what's available for purchase for systems? Because I understand unemployment, you're creating something completely new, but everything you mentioned for administering, large employers are already needing to do based on federal FMLA, and there are already softwares that you can utilize and subcontract with.
Okay, and just,
yeah.
And I'm sorry. Direct the question.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's new to me too, chair. But and you can also speak more to that when you sit forward. But I would ask the same question or let Cameron discuss that, because I think one of the lead questions I have is, so why is it so much? So, but please start with your presentation, and then we'll pepper you with questions as they come forward.
Whatever works for you.
Great, thank you.
Again, my name is Cameron Wood. I'm the director of the Unemployment Insurance Division for the Department of Labor. I've been in my position for nearly 3 years with the department, and when the bill last biennium first came out, I think there was a lot of conversation about actually structuring the program on top of the unemployment insurance program that we have, because of the similarities that there are between how I envision you would administer something like this. For those in the room, a quick overview of unemployment insurance. We collect taxes on wages that are paid to employees from employers. So we have the tax side. We also have the benefits side, where we have to take in claims, process those claims, and pay the benefits. And unemployment insurance, similar to what you have here in front of you, there is a monetary eligibility threshold that one has to meet in order to become eligible. There are additional eligibility criteria that one has to meet in order to be deemed eligible to receive unemployment insurance. So I'm just saying this to say that I think, you know, the programmatic structure you have in front of you is very similar to that. And as the commissioner mentioned, you know, going through our own modernization effort in trying to develop an IT system that would suffice for what we needed to, my biggest concern with putting into place a paid family leave program like this is making sure that everyone at the conversation is fully understanding of the complexities of a program like this and what it actually takes to build an IT system that would run this program. There are many, I think, other programs out there which I have not investigated, so I can't necessarily speak to, but what I can say is there aren't many programs like this in the country that have been implemented. So there may be things that employers have in place, but there aren't things that other states have in place that we can easily adopt. And so it becomes very tricky, as I'm happy to kind of go into detail with, as we're doing an unemployment insurance program. It becomes very difficult when you start to create different parameters in these IT systems to fit state law and to fit particular circumstances of state law. So for unemployment insurance, for example, the majority of what we do as a program is directed by federal law. There are really, you know, a smaller portion, you know, I'd say less than a quarter of unemployment insurance that's decided by the states, and but that 20% is drastically different across the states. So it becomes very difficult to find something that will fit for each state. It becomes very costly when you get in there and try and build something to address that 20%. So the biggest concerns I have with this are the dual administration of the program. When it was initially, when it kind of initially came to me and we started having conversations, it was originally going to be administered by the Department of Labor entirely. As we kind of moved down the road last biennium, it became a dual administration. You know, I don't want to speak for the tax department, but my understanding from testimony last year, they have a more modernized system, so it's a little easier for them to tweak that to help, I think, address some of the issues. But when it became a dually administered program, I think it just opens up a whole nother a whole other avenue of potential conflicts and choke points that I think would hinder us having actually an effectively administered program. So I'm not here to advocate for or against paid family leave. I'm not here to advocate for or against the this bill versus what the governor has proposed. I'm just here to tell you that in administering a program like this, I see a lot of challenges with that. And I'm happy to pose it to questions if that's how you would like to proceed, and we can try and flesh some things out that way, or try and address some big ticket items.
Well, sure. Just I'll go with Representative Gamache.
Thank you. Of the states that have built their own IT program for this, for paid family leave, have they done this in-house? Have they contracted out? If they've contracted out, are there certain companies that have the ability to be able to successfully build one of these systems?
So I can speak a little bit to that, somewhat on the unemployment insurance side. I'm not fully aware of all the other states that have paid family leave programs, because I know some of them are designing something more state level driven. I know some other states have more of a private insurance model. So I think the cost would be drastically different based on which way you go. I would want to confirm this number, but my recollection from last biennium when we were discussing, the state of Oregon was looking at,
Washington
was looking at, I think, $80 million to build a system to be able to administer their paid family leave program. I don't want to attest to the reality of that number, but I just recall that being a case. For unemployment insurance, most unemployment insurance programs across the country are aging, and so our unemployment insurance program, for example, runs off a mainframe computer and a technology called COBOL, which I've never even heard of before. So there are a lot of states across the country that are at a similar point. And so the U.S. Department of Labor, which is funding our project, has tried to incentivize states to get together and build these new modernized systems together to help drive down the costs. Most of the consortiums that have gone out to private vendors, they are available to build systems for unemployment insurance, have costs I've seen anywhere from $40, $50, $60 up to $90 million.
And what have we done?
For unemployment insurance?
No, to rebuild. You said you're moving ours into the 21st.
Yeah. So real quick, what we did, we joined a consortium with the state of Idaho, because we, as opposed to trying to go out and find a vendor and get a private company to then build the system for us, because we were looking at those costs, $40, $50, $60, $70 million, we decided to build. Vermont and the state of Idaho decided to take the IT systems that Idaho had, which they were in the process of modernizing themselves. They did it in-house. And we decided to enhance those systems, continue to modernize those systems, and add on Vermont's state requirements, as I was saying. So we decided as a consortium not to go with a private vendor because of the costs, and instead to do it more in-house as a joint distributed development. What I can tell you is they modernized half of their UI system in 2014. It cost them $9 million to do that, just as a general number. And as the commissioner mentioned, we, state of Vermont, by the time we get to the end of the project, will likely spend $20 million just in both payments to Idaho for their work, but also in our own in-house work in order to do that. The numbers are somewhat apples and oranges. We are building, we are modernizing something. There's a lot of work that goes into that wouldn't necessarily be the case for building something new. But in building a system like this, you are, I would imagine, in the tens of millions of dollars in trying to do so, whether you do it with a vendor or whether you do it in-house.
So this may be a question for you, Commissioner Curley. Do you know, or are you aware of what your responsibilities would be pertaining to eligibility, appeals, and such, under the voluntary plan that we heard about yesterday, sponsored by the governor? Will that be in your department?
That will be in our department, as I understand it, as I read the bill. I think that would involve a fair amount of rulemaking for us to really get the details down. Again, the only thing we really have to compare it to right now is our unemployment insurance program, which is, you know, like I said, we have appeals process. We have, you know, quite a crew that is paid by the, you know, they're funded by the federal government to do this. And our, again, you know, if we're, you know, if this is what we're handed, you know, we would figure that out, but we would have to add people, you know, medical staff to determine eligibility. You know, there would be a host of pieces that are, as Cameron said, so while we're comparing it to UI, it's very different, too. You know what I mean? Did I answer your question?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yep. Thank you. Voluntary program, not the bill.
Oh, I'm sorry. Will you ask your question again? Jess thinks I misunderstood what you asked.
I'm asking if the responsibility of eligibility and appeals and that sort of thing would come to the Department of Labor under the voluntary program sponsored by the
administration.
Yes.
I'm sorry. No. No.
Okay. Thanks for the clarification.
Thank you. I'm sorry. I thought you were referring to the bill.
So that would not come to you?
That would not come to us.
Okay.
Yeah, that would be through a private insurer.
And that's what I was wondering, if the insurance company would be responsible for that, or that would come to the state.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
So, Cameron, our employment system today, I mean, regardless of its age, it runs well. It's responsive. No, I'm just talking about, well, just the user interface. You know, the user interface, if I go online, I'm not using paper. I'm required not to use paper. So I go online. I'm just a Vermonter who's seeking my benefits. And behind that curtain, you're telling me that it's going to cost $20+ million just to renovate that system. And so two questions, which, the times that I've had to use unemployment, it's been sufficient and timely and responsive, and so to me, we run, no matter how much duct tape might be behind the curtain, we run an efficient system. And I think the commissioner testified that, I mean, we're all, as Vermonters, we're proud to get people their benefits on time.
Absolutely.
But in this case, first of all, who's paying for this? Is this a federally funded, federally subsidized program? So when we say we're paying $20 million or more, are we paying $20 million?
No, sir.
No, so it's a federal program.
We, the department has received multiple federal grants in order to design and build this new UI system. So we are not using state dollars in that sense.
And so, if you could, I know I'm asking you to get geeky here, but I think it's important to know it's for us to not be scared of hardware and software issues. I mean, no matter how many employees, and you pick a number, how many employees it would cost to run this program, to administer this program, say 25 or whatever the number has been bandied about. So let's say that's a couple thousand dollars or more for workstations. So the hardware thing is not very expensive. Why would it cost $20 million to develop the lines of software necessary when we know, even if it's COBOL, we know the general gist of how the existing system works? It's hard. I think it's hard for me to understand. Where does that money go? What does it go into?
So I can talk a little bit about our internal work. I'll start by saying I do not profess, although I'm somewhat younger, to be IT proficient in any way, shape, or form. Even though we are building this somewhat in-house, the unemployment insurance system. Like I said, we're not going out and hiring a private vendor to come in and do the entire, you know, front to back for us. We still have to go out and hire contractors to do the work, and I think that in and of itself is where a lot of the costs will go in trying to design and develop this. You know, we have a project manager, one, for us, and actually I have three project managers for different aspects of the project, but the single project manager we have that's kind of at the very top of the organizational chart, he's $165 an hour. And I have four developers that are $125 and $115 an hour. I have a business analyst that's $125 an hour. You know, that alone is just for those five people, you know, $1.5 million. Please don't write my math down and correct me. It's over $1 million a year. And so trying to design, the other thing I would caution you is the implementation dates of this. Going out and trying to design a system like this is not something you can do within a year. We started officially kicked off our unemployment insurance project on July 1st of 2016. And we are looking at going live either late this fall or early next spring. And keep in mind, we're building off stuff that we have had for, you know, 75 years, not the technology, the program, UI has been around since the 30s. So, you know, you would think that we would know exactly what we need to do to design that, but you don't. You have to have... we would have to hire individuals to come in and actually design the system itself. So we have a bill here, but there are a lot of questions I have about what the intent of the legislature is in administering a program like this. And so we would have to develop rules, then we would have to design the system, then you have to hire people like business analysts to come in and translate that into something that the programmers can actually program. And then you have to, you know, we have $500,000 roughly set aside just for testing, just to hire testers to come in and help us test the system. I have an additional five of my staff that we have taken off of their daily operations to work with them. So we have almost 10 people. Their sole job is to test the system. Because the worst thing you want to do is, you know, go live with something that's just going to completely fall on its face. So... it's the manpower and the cost of that manpower that it takes to design and develop something like this is not cheap. So most of that $20 million will simply go into that. The four developers we have with the one business analyst, and we had a project manager under one of our contracts from 2015 when we signed with MathTech up to the end of this year, that contract alone for five people for roughly 4.5 years is over $5 million.
So if we had, again, I'm going to come back to the consumer side and then go behind the curtain a little bit. You talk about dual administration. If I'm looking at my paycheck and I see what my wages are and I see what my taxes are and if I see what my deductions are, this is merely another deduction.
Yes, sir.
All right, so it's a box.
Yes,
on my paycheck. So pay data or some whoever does paychecks, they're going to go, oh, we're going to click on this, and we're going to open that box, and now we're going to take from that those wages and plunk it into this box. And that money already goes into the little superhighways of wherever it's supposed to go. This goes to unemployment, this goes to Social Security, this goes to workman's comp, this would go to PFL, which is where I suppose the tax department would come in, about where the money resides, where the trust fund itself resides. And so that, if it was dual administration, that would leave the Department of Labor with creating a software that says, hey, I need to take a leave. Here's my application. Can you approve it? That to me sounds, from this side again, you know, it's just another box on my paycheck. So where do the difficulties come in? And if the money's over here and they tell you, hey, we have $1 million in this fund.
Right. So I agree, and you know, I throw some of these numbers out there because I think this is just what I have to compare it to. You know, there aren't many states that have gone forward and implemented something from scratch. So I think it's just difficult to have a true apples and oranges comparison. So if the bill as structured, if it were to pass in this manner, you're right in the sense that Department of Labor would only have to administer the benefits, arguably, the benefit side of this, which does help drive down our costs. I don't want to speak for the tax department. They have a newer system, and to the extent that they can tweak it to allow, add a box, tweak it to allow for just another deduction. But when you get into the back end, the things that I know aren't, I can imagine, I shouldn't know, I don't work for the tax department, aren't there in their system, are how you attach wages to someone's benefit, right? So, for example, in unemployment insurance, you have to have a certain amount of wages within what's called your base period. So the system has to track your wages by Social Security number, and we have to then, you apply, we look at your wages, the system has to make the calculation right there, whether or not you're eligible based on your wages. And then we have to lock those wages in because you're only eligible for 12 weeks within a, my understanding, 12 weeks within a 12-month period. And I imagine you can't use the same wages that make you eligible for 1 year to make you eligible again for the next year. Mm-hmm. So these are things that I think, you know, need to be fully clarified, but that would be the way I perceive this, same way in unemployment insurance. So what I don't know if the tax system is capable of doing, because it would be duly administered, we, labor, would receive the application for eligibility. We would then have to, if it's real time, it becomes, you know, I would argue more difficult, but we would have to then match that with the tax department's wage record data, because they're the ones collecting the contribution. They would, their system would then need to tell us whether someone's eligible or not, but it would then also need to attach those wages to the benefit year that our system has, because you can't use those wages again to make you monetarily eligible in a subsequent year. That's my understanding of how the bill would be, how it would work. That is what we do in unemployment, yes, sir. But so that's where I'm trying, that's where for me I see the connections, and so I'm thinking if it's a very similar program, in that way, we're using monetary eligibility, you're locking down your wages so you're not using them again for a subsequent year, and you're looking at what it's costing us to build our system. I mean, I think we would have some foundation with the tax department, but, you know, I don't want to speak for the tax department, but this isn't what they do, right? They don't use their wage data in this manner. We do.
But if you have this, if you purchase this, if you're purchasing this code to run this system, and I'm just going really black and white here. Why can't you copy and paste it?
So we had that conversation
and then tweet. Yeah.
We had some of that conversation last biennium, where the bill was. It was structured on UI, but the way it was written was it didn't match up with what we actually did, which we came in and said, you know, this isn't how our system works, so to change it wouldn't work that way. And so then we got into a conversation of, okay, well, can you build this onto your UI system? We as like the state of Vermont are in a difficult position to try and do that because we are in this consortium. We are trying to go live with our system. We have two other states in our consortium that are trying to go live with the system subsequent to us. To ask them to build this for us is many years down the road, even if they agreed to it, because what U.S. Department of Labor would come in and say is, you, state of Vermont, can't you know, prohibit those two states or delay those two states from going live with their UI system, because that's the purpose of this consortium, that's what they're funding us for. So could we ask them to help tweak the system to add on to it? Potentially. I just think the timing would be off. To what I think you, more specifically to what you said, can we copy it?
Or can you develop it in a way? I mean, this consortium doesn't sound like it allows you any flexibility in growing the system if you're concerned about other states. But if there's to rebuild a system that totally. All right, so maybe it's an exit off the highway, you know, where you're not collecting the data twice, or you know, you're saying, okay, here's this product that works with these four states, but how do we funnel our information into a program where you don't have to rebuild, you know, you have to reinvent the wheel, because that's what it sounds like. Right. $20 million venture is reinventing the wheel of inputting the material twice, as opposed to utilizing a system that we're paying for. You know, the idea that we have with all software in the state government, which is we're supposed to be tying it all together, so there's only a couple of clicks away from food stamps and from healthcare and from UI. Go ahead, and then after your question, then Tommy has.
Yeah. I was just going to say, I mean, do I think there are possibilities for that? Absolutely. The struggle we have, and I don't want to say this to come across as not being willing to work with you on this. We are in a difficult position because the money that we have from the U.S. Department of Labor to fund this project and the money that we have for the administration of unemployment insurance has to be spent and used for that purpose. So I agree with you, and I think you could try to drive down some of the costs by piggybacking off some of the things that we already do, but it then becomes whatever work would be done for a state level program would have to be paid for by the state. And I don't think that means that you can't do it, right? People have responded to me and said, okay, so what's the cost? You know, and so I'm just trying to acknowledge that. And not trying to protect us. It's just the reality that we can't. We have to be very careful about how you go about doing that. Not saying it can't be done, but so that was the conversation we had in the committee, and I tried to tell them you can't just take UI and make it work for paid family leave in the same system. Can you leverage the code, or can you leverage information that we've already have to help? Can you, try to utilize the services that we've created to look at eligibility and match it to the wages in our system, try and take that code to use it to branch off to a paid family leave program? I'm not an IT guy, so I want to sit here and say, I think you can, I don't see why not. And does that drive down the cost? I imagine it would. But that, that whole thing needs to be fleshed out, right? If you're using UI wage record information, then that opens up a whole host of questions I have, because the way the bill is designed, it would be the tax department collecting the money and not the Department of Labor. We, labor, did the healthcare assessment when it was initially put in place up until just a few years ago. And we had to receive state funding in order to administer that program. And we had to do a lot of work to make sure that we segregated those functions out. And we actually had to go to, one of the tricky pieces is when we trying to be effective for the businesses, if we tried to collect information on unemployment and paid family leave at the same time, for example, which I think we would all agree is what you would want to do. We want to make it efficient for both the state and the employer. When you start to do that, you mix unemployment insurance with a state-level program, you have to bring USDOL in, and they essentially have to sign off on it. When we did the healthcare assessment, I was not there, but from my understanding of the people that were there when we were designing it, even down to the forms that we created to gather information on the healthcare assessment, USDOL came in and said, okay, your form is this much of it's healthcare related, and you're going to spend this much time of your auditors doing healthcare, and they came up with a percentage of what they expected the state to pay in order to administer it. So can it be done? Yes. I'm just highlighting that's what the details will get into.
It's all important for us to know. Representative Wallace.
On the technical side of it, I can see the issues that you're having with the federal involvement here. But on the technical side, there are at least two approaches to take. One is you could have one massive system with different interfaces, depending on the department, or you could make sure your data dictionaries are clean and that, I am a geek. Yeah, and you allow portals, even if you are running different pieces of software. And so there are technical ways for which this can be completely solved, and it doesn't have to be horrendously expensive. It doesn't have to be $80 million.
I agree.
It definitely would be millions, but not 80.
Yes, sir. No, I absolutely agree. And that's where I'm saying, you know, like we have wage record, and so, again, do I think you could utilize that? Yes, you know, when you're talking portals, I'm hearing words that I hear every day with our new system. So, I agree with you. My concern, though, is you would still need the benefit side of the house to administer the program, which I... Unless you're building it on top of the UI system or within the UI system, that would still need to be built. I think you can still leverage interfaces and leverage information that we already have, but the benefit side would have to still be built, which is just as complex as the tax side. I mean, you need the individual's information. You need to know, I imagine you would establish a benefit year, 12-month period. You would need to know how many payments are going out the door. You would need a system that would allow you to collect overpayments for when people are found to, you know, defraud the system. It's going to happen. That's one thing I told, you know, the committees last year when we looked at the original like staffing of the program. This is in no way, shape, or form adequate. You're going to have a lot of these things that I think people just don't initially think of. You know, I have a staff to run unemployment. We have a staff of 80 to 90 people. My annual admin budget is in the $7 million range. And, you know, I think you can shave some of that off because I don't think you know, there are some things we do that you don't necessarily need for this program, but, you know, you're asking us to make claims determinations in 5 days, a maximum of 10. That's extremely difficult to do. You know, I mean, for now, we don't have a federal mandate for that. We have performance measures we have to meet. We're expected to pay a certain percentage of claims within 14 days on the unemployment insurance side. So, just trying to make sure you all have that clear picture.
While
so absolutely
here,
agree with
while
you.
Well, we have to be here. That's what we need. Representative Zott.
One at least relatively quick question, which is, I've heard you talk before and I've heard other people talk before about the consortium. And it's clear that there are some advantages to the consortium, but I've also heard kind of over and over how being in the consortium hamstrings you.
Yes, sir.
So working with other states can be a complicating factor and hinder the ease of administration of work.
Absolutely.
Okay. And then my second question is, when you explain all the technical difficulty and all the sort of costs associated with it, I think of a private provider as proposed, as used in some states and as proposed in possibly in this state. And so I'm wondering, and you may not be able to answer this, where do you think those private entities will be recouping those costs? And how will they manage, you know, like, who's going to ultimately end up paying for all the costs that you're talking about with the private side? Like, how are they going to make up that cost to their own organization?
I have no idea how I would answer that.
But they would have to.
My presumption, if you went that road, is yes, sir, they would have to. But it's, you know, it's, my imagine would be, where is the money and who's holding the money? You know, I mean, if you're asking private insurers to do this and you're paying, you know, like premiums to them, then they're collecting that money and then they can invest that and make money off that. And that's how they would turn around and invest in the system that it would take to run this.
But they may not. I'm following your question. I was like, do they have a plug and play system where they would be able to monitor, you know, where that's the question is, like, do they have a plug and play system that we're just recreating, or, you know, does it make sense to just, and I don't know the answer to that. We will know until we hear from the insurance companies that have been requested for information. Right. Any further questions for Cameron? This is, I thank you for, I mean, we're peppering you and you know, we feel like there's some high test stuff, but it is our desire to get as much information as we can is really insatiable at this point. So, Representative Gamache.
Yes. I'm wondering, assuming we would go forward and a new system would be built, it would take, it then takes people to monitor that system and to do all that's necessary to connect all the dots and so on. Have you any idea how many employees that might involve? And do you think it would be additional employees to what we now have?
I would pose that question to ADS. You know, so we have
digital services.
So we have IT staff that do maintain our current systems. You know, we expect to have IT staff that will maintain the new system as we go forward. You would need that in order to administer this program. As far as how many or who, I would defer that question to them. I think currently we have running our UI system or helping to support the back end of our UI system, I think we have 1, 2, 3, you know, 5 to 6 people, give or take, and I would ask for more.
But, was your question also like the administration piece? Like,
yes,
would we need other staff?
Right.
Yes.
I mean, to me, it would seem likely that you would need additional staff because the staff that is maintaining the systems that now exist are doing that. So I'm not envisioning that same staff or that same level of staffing would be adequate.
Depending on what the technology is written in, you know, so we're, and here's where I'm going to, I'm getting back into the world of IT where I'm not as familiar, you know, we're writing our new system in a certain code base. And if the department is maintaining this and a paid family leave program, and they're written in 2 separate code bases, mm-hmm. then you know you're not going to have staff that can overlap. But if it's written in a similar language, then you know in theory some staff can overlap. But you would still need additional people. How many? I do not want to say. I would defer to Agency of Digital Services. But
can I ask a follow up? So this is going a little bit away from that. When you talk about different code systems,
yes, ma'am.
We have different code systems operating now.
Across the state, I'm sure, yes. Mm-hmm. But
The reason I ask that is that I've heard that generally referred to as being problematic in terms of computer systems not being able to speak with each other.
I don't think it's as problematic as it used to be. I think nowadays they have there is the capability of getting programs, even written in different languages, to talk to each other. I think it becomes more of an issue when you're talking about maintaining them. If you have 2 systems with 2 different code bases, then, you know, if I'm an expert in this code base, then I'm not going to know how to maintain this code base. And so then, like I said, you don't have that overlap, whereas if they're in the same language, then, you know, you hope you can drive down a little bit of the staff cost because people would understand the language of both and be able to maintain both. But I think nowadays in the modern technology, I mean, I think we can... my understanding and having conversations with our staff as we're modernizing is it's not as difficult to get different codes to talk to each other than maybe it used to. So.
Well, that's good to know.
And so, and just in H107, the cost estimate does include 7.5%, whatever the percentage was per year for administrative costs. So part of that 0.93% in H107 is for that annual cost. Representative
Clark,
did you have a question?
Well, since this is an ongoing conversation, the Joint Fiscal Office showed us a modeling program,
yes.
And was all of your IT costs and all of your expected personnel costs given to the last time they did that last year? or has things changed so much?
We've given them what we could. But honestly, we haven't had the opportunity or the resources to really do the research.
Yeah.
And so it's really hard for, I mean, this is just like guessing. It's sure. hard to, I mean, Jane Fiscal's done so much work, but we can't say that we've had, like I said, the time, the resources to do the work. It's like a shot in the dark for us.
You had said there was 26 people administering, if I understood you, 26 people administering the unemployment benefits?
No, sir, no. I have a staff of 80 to 90 people.
So how many staff do you think would have to administer this?
So we did provide some information, just to your first point. We did provide some, I think, staffing, administrative, and IT. We're not experts in what it costs for IT systems, so we worked with Dan Smith at Joint Fiscal Office, which is still there, but we worked a little bit with him to talk about IT costs. We did try to provide as best of information as we could on the administration of the program and what the annual administrative costs would be, but that was based off the bill that I think came out of the House last year, which was administered fully by the Department of Labor. We didn't fully go down that road, I think based on more of a joint administrative model, and so I think would take a little more research to look into. How many people would it take to administer this? That's something that I, you know, would advise you to fully flesh out and to come back and have a conversation. It depends on how you want the program structured. And I don't mean to kind of kick it back to you in that manner. I know some of that has to be designed by the department and fleshed out by the department. We're the experts in that. But, for example, I've seen estimates of only 1,000 people utilizing this program a year, and I can tell you, I, just based on my experience, think that's vastly underestimated. And you're asking us to provide benefits in 5 days. You know, we don't do that in unemployment insurance. And just in our call center, we have 24 staff. And, you know, that's two supervisors, that's give or take, it's two supervisors, three admins. I think the first staffing note I saw had half an admin for the entire program, which is not feasible. Three admins. We have, I think it's 6 or 7 customer service representatives. It is their sole job to help take phone calls all day, every day, to initiate the claims taking process. We have about an equal number of adjudicators, because what you're going to run into is there's going to be people that we're going to deny benefits, or they're not going to provide us the necessary information, or they're going to provide us information and the employer or someone else is going to provide contrary information, and then that's going to need to be adjudicated in order for us to make a determination. Depending on how many people you have in the program at one time will depend on how long that takes. You know, during our busy season at the for unemployment insurance, you know, we do the best we can, but I'm sure you have heard maybe from your constituents or may have experienced, we get very high call volumes, and sometimes up to an hour maximum wait time for people, and sometimes it takes weeks to administer the actual adjudication of a claim. So if you want us to maintain that time frame of making a determination in 5 days or 10 days, you know, your staff numbers just went through the roof in order to maintain that. But there are things that surround this that, you know, I think need to be fleshed out. For example, the definition of employee is a tax definition. It's someone who's, you know, required to have income withheld. That's not in a labor definition. So what do we do in the situation? We see it in unemployment insurance all the time. Someone files for benefits. We don't have wages in the system for them because their employer isn't reporting them as an employee. So we then have to have an auditor go out and make a determination of whether that individual is an employee or not. And then we have to get the wages from the employer if they are, put it on the system, then make the person eligible. You're going to run into the same thing with this. And who is administering that piece? If we're relying on the tax department to tell us whether somebody's monetarily eligible, who's making the determination for those individuals that don't have wages? We send a request to the tax department, they send it back. Nope, there is no withholding. are you going to hold that against the claimant when they may have been misclassified? And how do you make that determination? Who makes that determination? And how do you go about recouping the cost of the employee? You know, for us, it's the, you know, the cost is borne by the employer. So we get to go and we say, employer, you misclassify this person, give us the wages, now you owe us the tax contributions. You're going to say to a claimant, potentially, I guess, these are questions I have, right? You say to a claimant who tries to file, we don't have your wages. Somebody goes out and makes a determination, oh, you're an employee, but guess what? You haven't paid the contribution for this entire time. So now, in order to collect this benefit, you need to pay us X number of dollars. I don't know if that's what your intention is or not, but those are the types of struggles I see with a potential dual administration of a program like this, and where you're applying tax definitions on one side, labor definitions on another side. So, you know, we have 9 auditors that go out and do this. Do you have a similar expectation that we have that type of program? We have 9 staff, give or take. It is their sole job to work with employers on the employer side, filing their reports, answering questions. I don't know that you would need that many, because if it's as it's set up, it's more of a withholding, and I think it's a little more straightforward. But you need staff for that. Employers are going to have questions. We have finance individuals who maintain our trust fund. You're going to need that. We have 10 staff dedicated to program integrity. They audit claims and make determinations of people who are put in overpayment who shouldn't have been paid, and they collect the overpayment amounts. That's going to happen. You're going to need that staff in order to it's going to happen. You're going to have people who are going to try to file who shouldn't be eligible, and then you're going to have to try to recoup the benefit from them. One thing the commissioner mentioned, I didn't catch it, but it seems to be there in the bill, you know, how much quality assurance do you want in the program? You know, we have 5 staff, and it's their sole job, 5 staff plus a supervisor, so 6 staff. And this is a federal requirement, so you may not want this piece, but it's their sole job to audit us internally to make sure we are making the proper determinations. You know, we do have an improper payment rate. We do pay some people improperly and then have to go back and recoup the cost. It's just the nature of a program. And so, you know, whether you want that level of quality assurance, you know, I would advise it, but, you know, it's up to you. So these are questions that I'm more than happy to come back and flesh out or provide, you know, if you're seeking information from us about more how we structure unemployment insurance. Happy to provide as much information as we can. Again, my hope of coming here today was just to make sure that everybody's having that conversation, because in my experience so far, it hasn't necessarily been fleshed out as much.
No, that's why we had you in. I'll let you
You know, thanks for all that. I guess I have more of a request than a question on how you were laying everything out there with the staffing needs that you would foresee for your department to take on the workload with this. Do you have that kind of like flushed out in a document format or anything?
I think we can see what we had from last year, and then, you know, I think we can, as an initial matter, submit that. I would, you know, just with the caveat that it was on last year's information, but...
Different structure.
What I was saying, kind of like with this, because, like, structurally speaking, you know, I mean, to apply those numbers of cost of operation would be very valuable.
I don't want to speak for the commissioner. I'm happy to help provide as much information on that as possible. Again, I think it would be with a lot of assumptions built in.
No, of course. But, yeah, I mean, nothing's set in stone. Everything's fluid right now. So, but just to see it as projected line items would be nice.
And just before you go, before we switch witnesses, I want to go back to your global comment. It just made me laugh because 20 years ago plus, I heard a story that NASA was actually on eBay looking for Intel 286 chips to run their shuttles because, you know why, they were simpler. And they were able to put ships into space without the bloat that now exist in operating systems. So,
well, we struggle to find COBOL, you know, folks that are COBOL. What's the word?
Savvy.
Thank you. And you know, the one or two that are left are in our department are very,
like
very close to retiring. So yeah, so we're pretty excited to get into a different program.
Nice to them.
Oh, we have,
like, from, like, Abacus to Pencil to COBOL, right?
Yeah. I love that he said he was too young to remember it. I remember it.
I just always think it's great because it gives me assurance that our system is secure, because I'm not sure anybody hacked into them today with no how. So,
well, thank you for your time. It's a lot of information for us to process, and I appreciate you coming in. Wait, Dirk, were you gonna? Did you have anything, or were you just playing backup?
I can talk as long as you want, but I know there's a lot of witnesses. If I can raise a couple issues.
Sure.
For
get on the record.
3 or 4 minutes.
Here, Dirk, come sit.
Okay, thanks. So, for the record, Dirk Anderson, General Counsel, Department of Labor. I just want to reiterate what Cameron and the Commissioner have said. You know, we are not here to, you know, argue about policy issues, and we're not giving you all this information as a way of saying this is too complicated, we can't do it. We just want you to be aware of the nuts and bolts and the realities of administering a benefit program and what that's going to require. And Cameron's talked about a lot of aspects of that. I just want to add a couple of things. Every claim we get, I mean, some are going to be black and white, you know. If you're having a baby, you're having a baby. But we're going to, every claim, potentially there's going to be an issue, is if it's the illness of a family member, is it a qualifying family member? You know, there's a list, but individuals may not feel that their stepfather, you know, they may treat them like their father. You know, their spouse may, they may not be married, there may not be a spousal relationship under the law, as I presumably we would have to define that rule, but you know, we're going to have to look at that with every claim that comes in. We're going to have to determine in serious illness. Your idea of what a serious illness is may be very different from the definition in the statute, which would presumably be further fleshed out in rule. But we'd have to have, presumably, in order to adjudicate these claims properly, you know, we'd have to have some sort of, you know, medical staff, I don't know if that's a doctor or a nurse or what, but somebody's going to, if somebody says, here's what I have, we're going to have to determine, well, you know, how severe is it, that kind of thing. And anybody who disagrees with our determination is going to have the right to appeal that determination. There's some pretty tight turnaround times set in statute, in this bill. You know, currently for the unemployment insurance program, we have, Cameron said, I think 9 claims adjudicators.
I think so.
We have 3 administrative law judges. You know, their turnaround times aren't it's federal guidelines that we're supposed to comply with, but they're not as tight as what's required by this bill. They're going to have to get evidence, you know, have an evidentiary hearing, that kind of thing. What else did I want to say? And this is a policy issue for everyone to consider. It's nothing that we're taking a position on, but this bill provides for 12 weeks of 100% wage replacement. That's pretty generous. It also says, an individual is disqualified in any week in which they are receiving either a workers' compensation benefit or an unemployment insurance benefit. So people are going to make decisions based on the various benefit to them of those programs. So the potential is there, if this bill passes, that somebody who was injured at work and ought to report that as a workplace injury may say, well, I'm only going to get 66% wage replacement. I'd rather get 100% wage replacement for 12 weeks. And then when the 12-week runs out and they're still injured or unable to return to work, and then they file a workers' compensation claim, We're going to have to figure that out. Unemployment insurance benefits, roughly 45% wage replacement, right? A little more?
I'd want to check that.
Okay. But
a little higher.
Maybe closer to 50, capped at $498 a week. So, again, if you are laid off, normally if you are laid off, you would file an unemployment claim, and we would give you those benefits. An individual who has an upcoming layoff may decide, well, you know, I'm pregnant. I'm just going to do this as a paid family leave thing and get more benefits. Or somebody who is ill, may go that route because it's a more generous benefit. Not saying, it's good or bad. I'm just saying that, is this program going to potentially be paying for people who more properly would be receiving benefits under a different program from a different pot of money? In other words, there may be an incentive there for people to apply for a benefit that is not necessarily the appropriate benefit.
So, two things. The UI department is huge, and I appreciate you really emphasizing that.
Sure.
And again, what we see on our end is just the claimants, for instance. Right. Like, we can say, oh, there's only 400 claimants this week, or whatever that is, or new claimants, or whatever the numbers are, which is, again, we have to try to bridge that chasm between what does that mean for you overall, because obviously it's a big program with a very small window into our world.
Right.
But on all these questions here, what is the fraud rate in unemployment? Do you have a number? Can you get us a fraud rate for the last 5 years of people that do try to work the system? Because the number we got from Rhode Island on workers' comp, on family leave, was less than 1% over time.
So, to that point, I can see what I can pull together. It's a potentially two different questions, just to clarify. So there's fraud, people who are intentionally trying to receive a benefit and lying to us in order to receive it. That may be a little tougher to get, but I'm happy to look. But then there's also an improper payment rate. As I mentioned, we do pay people, and unfortunately, it is a reality of the system, and I'm happy to share that. I mean, we do as much as we can to try and not pay people when they don't, aren't eligible or don't deserve the benefit, if you will. But we make incorrect determinations where people aren't trying to defraud us, but we are paying improperly. And so two separate numbers that I'm happy to try to get for you. Happy to try to look for 5 years. I think Vermont, I was actually looking at the improper payment number just the other day for the past year. And I'm wanting to say we were at 3% over a 4-quarter period. And again, that's not necessarily people who have tried to defraud the system, separate question, but our improper payment rate, I'm wanting to say, was about 3%, but that was on a sample of, 350 claims, and that equated to, I think, and I'm happy to get this information and give it to you, I think that was $2 million of, improper payments that we then have to account for on the back end of trying to go in, make a determination that it's improper, allow due process to go through, and then try and collect that money back from the individual. So just, when you're setting up the program, know that that's a lot of work on the back end too.
Thanks. Representative Long.
Just following up on that, you had mentioned earlier you have internal audit required by the federal government.
Yes, ma'am.
Five people on staff, I think you said.
Yes, ma'am.
That do that all the time. Is that where you will get this information from your internal issues?
That is where most.
So yes, would ma'am. That also show, those audits would also show fraud if there's or not?
Two separate units.
That's what I'm trying to get at.
Yeah. So our what's called our BAM unit, which stands for Benefit Accuracy Measures, mm-hmm. they audit us internally to see whether we are administering the program according to law, policies, procedures. Mm-hmm. That's where we get our improper payment rate from. Mm-hmm. So they will audit a claim front to back and see whether or not we made the correct determination, whether we allowed benefits or denied benefits. If we allowed benefits, they look at the claimant's their benefit year and go in and look at every single week they filed and try to make sure whether the payments were proper. That's where we get the improper payment rate. A separate unit called our program integrity unit, they deal with auditing claimants, not auditing us, but auditing claimants to make sure that they are reporting correctly. And that's where we would get information on fraud. And it's a little different, but this is a question I would pose to the committee. So the only disqualifying criteria currently, my recollection of what's in the bill, is receiving workers' comp or receiving unemployment insurance. And my question to you would be, is this intended to be a wage replacement for these individuals? And if that is the case, there are a host of other mechanisms in which somebody could receive payment where we deny them for unemployment. So if you are receiving wages, you're required to report them to us. If you receive sick pay, vacation pay, all that stuff. Some of that's not applicable. I get that. But that's where we see a lot of fraud from claimants, is they're unemployed, they're actually working, receiving wages, and they're not telling us. And so then we do cross matches on the back end. Employers report the wages. We look at all these individuals were filing. Were they filing? Were they reporting the wages that have now been reported to us by the employers? We find out they weren't, and so then we have to go in and do that investigation. So, two
and
separate
we'll reviews of the questions. Legislation. So, thank you. I'm gonna switch out here. I think I need 5 minutes just to stand up and before we get to our next witness. But
happy to come back.
Yeah, no, thank you very much. And if we could just take a couple of minutes, more than 5 minutes. I'm gonna restart the clock at 10.
What are the federal guidelines for term?
We are on the record. All right, thank you very much. And I would just like to thank everybody for, that was a lot of information, and I appreciate the department for coming in and sharing it, and I'm sure we could spend three more hours, you know, pulling out that same information. But I did want folks who have come up to testify, both Doug and Angela, that were on time, kind of on a time frame, so if we start asking questions again with more speed,
yes,
it's in respect to you getting to where you need to be next. So.
And I'm a fast talker, and my talking quickly is for the same reason. You can ask me to slow down if you need to.
Okay, so please introduce yourself for the record and tell us why you're here.
Sure. I'm Angela Earl Gray. I'm the Director of Human Resources at Chroma Technology. We're in Bellows Falls, high-tech manufacturing, about 130 people, employee-owned, pretty innovative. And I'm here to speak in support of H-107. And before I start talking about that, I just want to give a little bit more background on me, because sometimes people that are familiar with Chroma go, oh, it's employee-owned, it does profit sharing. You have lots of things to leverage that a normal business wouldn't. So your perspective is really unique. I just want to mention I've been doing HR since 1992. Prior to being at Chroma, all of my experience was nonprofit experience, so I'm used to having small budgets. And I also am on the steering committee for the Brattleboro Area Human Resource Network and do HR trainings throughout the state. So I informally mentor a lot of people and hear a lot of different perspectives. From an HR perspective, it would be incredibly exciting to offer paid family leave as long as it was a meaningful program, as long as it was something that people would really utilize and would make a difference in our workplaces. CROMA currently offers short-term disability to our employees. They get 12 weeks out, up to 60% of their pay. We put in place a maternity paternity leave program, which gives newer employees 60% of their salary. Employees who've been with us a long time, we actually upped that benefit to 80%. And one of the pieces was recognizing that at times, 60% of your income isn't enough for you to really use leave. If you don't have a strong support system, if you don't have accumulated assets, if somebody tells you, take a significant pay decrease, or inconvenience yourself, push yourself when you shouldn't be, you go to work. And that's just the reality of it. So we have sick leave, personal time, other things that can help offset it, and we see that people have no hesitancy to take advantage of short-term disability when they have those and are able to offset the difference. But when they start to run out of time, they start to try to push themselves to come in, and that's with a workforce that's well-paid, has good 401k, is accumulating stock, long-term has a sense of financial stability, and they still worry about a pay decrease. So for people at a lower end of the income range, not getting 100% is a big deal. Also, just in terms of the system working, it really does need to be universal because the more scale, the better it is for cost. The reasons that we offer the benefits that we do, just to give CROMA credit, the very first one is ethics. We believe in it. We would do it even if it didn't make good business sense. We recognize and see the ways that it does, but we would do it either way. And I think and hope everyone feels that way, that if it wasn't cost prohibitive, if it wasn't too much work, you would want people to be able to take care of themselves. And we're gonna speak to you assuming that that's the case. So one of the other pieces I just wanted to mention is that we have our health insurance plan is more generous than typical. It's self-funded, but we utilize a third-party private insurance company to do all of our administration. And that company is trained. They want to be making a profit. They want to be making as much of a profit as possible. So even when we're asking them to not, you know, be rule lawyering, you know, saying to somebody, gee, this came in on day 11 and it would have been fine if it came in on day 10, but sorry, you're denied. We have to get involved over and over again personally to keep that from happening because they have such a high motivation and that's the way they're trained. Even the people that we've told and talked to about it in the past revert to, this is what we do. We're trying to maximize our profit. And anything that's run by a private company, that's what they're going to do, maximize their profit. Where with the state, again, thinking that your ethics are you want people to actually be able to utilize this benefit, they're going to have a much better chance of being able to do that. Other reasons that we offer strong benefits or that we see a business case for it, recruiting and retention. We differentiate ourselves as an employer by offering strong benefits. And the question comes up, then why would you want every employer in the state to do it? And there's two reasons. When you are an employer who gives people strong benefits for family leave, and they have a partner or spouse that works for a company that doesn't give them strong benefits, then every time anything happens in their family, your employee is the one that takes time off. We recognize and realize that we get utilized more because we're a generous employer, and it actually works against us in some ways to be giving those benefits because other employers are able to step back and not give the same thing to the spouses of our own partners. The other piece that I want to touch on, and I apologize because I'm trying to go fast so I'm not going through my full notes, but the piece in terms of abuse. Again, I've worked in HR since 1992. One of the nonprofits I worked for did care for people with developmental disabilities that were combative. We had all sorts of workers' comp cases. We had all sorts of people out of the workplace. In my entire career, I know of two people who seem to be pushing a little further. It wasn't that there was nothing at all, but that they were saying, gee, I can't come back in, when really we could have given them a modified work assignment. People want to be doing the right thing. You take pride in your work. There's a wait period for before this bill kicks in. So you've established relationships with your colleagues. You self-identify based on your profession and your job. And when you're able to, you want to be a contributing member of society. There's a myth that people are looking for holes to exploit in a system. And it's a little bit of a classist myth, because every time we think of it, we think that people like us wouldn't do it, but they will do it if we give them the opportunity to. And that hasn't played out in terms of anything I've seen in the workplace. When you talk about the work involved in administering FMLA, as I said, your employers are already doing that work. Any employer that has more than 50 people in the country, if they have somebody that's out, we have 5 days to notify them of their rights under FMLA. A certificate goes to their doctor. Their doctor has to sign off and say that they have a serious medical condition. It's very well defined. It has gone to court many, many times, so everyone clearly understands what is or isn't a serious medical condition. And again, in the course of the work that I've done as an employer, getting those forms back twice, we've gone, we want additional information from this doctor's office because it seems funky or odd. That you would have to have your doctors being willing to participate in fraud of the system to have a lot of fraud in the system. And that just isn't something we've seen happen. So, again, you know, we have to track the time that they're out. We have to do proper notifications. The only thing that would be different about the state doing it than employers doing it is the money aspect, which absolutely I know adds complexity and is something that's going to need to be dealt with. But the reality is, if employers that are 50 or larger are already doing it and are already doing it on the same tight time deadlines, I would assume that the state, if you centralize the function, if you have people that do it much more frequently, for a lot of employers it comes up, you know, a few times a year. So if you have people that this is your job, you're really well trained on it, it's centralized, economy of scale, it's going to be more efficient, it's going to be less expensive to run. So I'll mention those. Just going back real quick. The other piece I just want to go back to, and I know you hear this all the time, but is recruiting in Vermont. And that recruiting in Vermont is hard, and it's getting harder. And you have all the numbers, but I know that, you know, this is the 6th month in a row that our unemployment rate is lower than it was. And I can tell you, we're a great employer. We get 40 to 150 applicants per position. Still, in terms of tracking our metrics, the amount of time it takes us to fill roles has gone up by 18 days in the last 2 years. You know, it is harder and harder to bring people in. We're talking about it all the time. We're doing really neat programs, and it's not getting better. And to give the governor's office some credit for it, there's some things that have happened that have been really neat and innovative. The pay people to move here and work remotely. That got so much free press. The amount that, of marketing that we got for the cost of that program is amazing. And every time we pass progressive workplace laws, that's what happens. It goes out into the world that Vermont is someplace that cares about having people come and be a part of our community and takes care of our community. And then we as employers can go out and market for you. We're going to seize it. We're going to jump on it. It's going to be a really good bang for your buck in terms of an investment on getting people to move here is staying on the cutting edge.
Representative Trina?
Yeah.
So the incentive, remote work incentive program only works if you can work remotely. And the issues in Vermont right now are that remote areas of the state are where the employment problems lie, and that program cannot attract people to come and do that if there's no internet.
I agree with you completely. I am in a remote area of the state. But what I will tell you is that we've had applicants from across the country who, because of hearing about the fact that Vermont was doing that, looked at us as a state and went, wow, that's really neat. I've never thought about moving to Vermont. Would it work to me or not? You know, that there's a certain amount that's just, what is the message we're sending to the country, right? We want to be taking care of our people. We want to be taking care of our employers. And something like that is huge for employers, and it's huge for small employers. You know, if I can't get a new employee, then we're pushing back lead time on shipping something. I have a lot of friends who own small businesses in Windham County. If they can't get employees, it means they're working longer and longer hours until they finally give up. And we have definitely had businesses in Windham County that have closed based on nothing but we can't find people to hire.
Just to follow up, change a
sure.
little bit. I've always held the opinion that, and for you for, who's been in HR for a long time, I've always held the opinion that a content worker is a better worker. That a content worker who is taken care of and looked after by their employer and has good benefit packages works harder.
Yes.
And that harder work, I'm asking, the question is that harder work, I've always believed that turns into loyalty, less training costs from turnover, and ultimately profitability. Is that something that I'm on track with from your experience?
From my perspective and experience, absolutely. Yeah. It is exactly what Chrome is founded on, that if we take care of our employees, they will be engaged, they will be contributing at a higher level, that we will be able to have less employees producing a higher volume of work.
Yeah.
And it's true. We don't want employees in our workplace who are sick. We don't want employees in our workplace who are distracted thinking about sick family members, because it risks infecting other staff members, and their quantity and quality of work isn't as good as you would want. And none of us want it, right? You don't want to go into a cafe where somebody's working when they're sick because they have to. There's no job where it's a good idea to have somebody who's not capable of doing their best work being in the workplace.
Thank you. Representative
Sorry. You mentioned having difficulty finding employees, and is there a common denominator of what that is about?
So, and I can say this more from my work with my HR group than other things. I think that there's multiple things. I think not having good internet and not having good infrastructure is an issue. In Windham County, I think we have issues with not having diversity. The people who are wanting to move around and resettle in new locations right now are not necessarily all middle-aged and white. And the times that we recruit people from outside our region into our region, and they look different and have different interests, they fit in well in our company and then come and tell us that they don't fit in well in our communities. I think that's
so
a big piece.
Are you saying that you're not getting local people?
We get local people.
Vermonters?
We get local people and we get Vermonters. Some of it's just the low unemployment rate that people are able to, you know, we hire for second shift a lot. There's a lot of people that don't want to work second shift. There are a lot of people that are able to be more specific about exactly what they are and aren't willing to do because the unemployment rate is so low. We definitely have specialized high-tech things that we look for that we have to, you know, easily could spend 6-8 months looking for a position. There are times we've closed things and gone to using consultants or gone, how do we solve this in a different way? But even entry-level positions, there's a lot going on in the state for workforce and development. We're involved in a lot of it. We just started our own internal apprentice program. We're talking about doing training with CCV on site. But at the end of the day, there is a definite skill knowledge gap. We still have a lot of people in Vermont that can't even use computers, you know, and we're a highly automated firm. I can't, you know, you can be somebody who's
issue.
Yep, you can be somebody who's worked for a long time. We have a lot of people that are getting laid off after years in the same job using the same very small, narrow skill set and are needing a lot of retraining.
Representative Collette.
Oh. What are the federal guidelines for turnaround?
We have to notify people of their rights in FMLA within 5 days. They have 15 days to get us paperwork, and then we have to give them a determination. I think it's within 5 days. I frankly, sometimes tell like my assistants and my generalists that they have to do it within a shorter period to make sure we're compliant, but I think it's 5.
So in the bill we're talking about,
it's same.
The administration felt that was the 5 days was totally inadequate.
Yeah.
From your experience as an employer.
I mean, it's not fun. It's something that employers find challenging to do, and you have to work out a system once you get to the size of being able to comply. What generally happens is you hit 50 people, you go, oh no, I need to do this and I don't know how to yet. You try to do some spreadsheets when you're having, you know, 3 or 4 of them a year, and then once you get larger, you move to outsourcing the administration aspects of it, and then you're just typing everything in and they're doing the processing from there. I could easily imagine system set up with the state where it's the same thing, that your employer is typing in your initial data, your employer is flagging you on if they think there's something odd about it or not, and that people are getting involved at a higher level if there's warning signs based on kind of volume and
okay. And norms. Unemployment, is that turnaround the same kind of window, federal guidelines?
I don't know, okay. Because employers don't have close to as much involvement in unemployment. But I will also say that I truly hope the state considers looking at some of those systems that already exist for FMLA administration, because we interact with a lot of the state software systems and a lot of things that get developed in-house. There's not necessarily a partnering with people that are going to use them during the development, and they end up being pretty cumbersome. Yeah.
Speaking to wage replacement or levels, both you said both your short-term disability and your maternity are at 60%.
Our maternity for employers who have been with us for more than 5 years is 80% actually, and we increased that specifically trying to get more utilization. We definitely find, especially with fathers, that if they're not getting wage replacement at a high level, you know, I think it should be 100%. If they're not getting it, then it's I'll be there for the first 2 weeks, I'll be there for. Oh, and just one other thing in terms of workers' comp that I wanted to mention, because when he was talking about the interplay with workers' comp and FMLA currently run concurrently. So I think with this program, unless you design something else into it, what would happen would be I would have workers' comp. I would be getting 60% from my workers' comp. I would file FMLA. It wouldn't? Okay. It wouldn't run concurrently at all, or it would?
It wouldn't. It's okay. Specifically
excluded. Okay. That's fine. Yep.
Yes.
Thank you.
So is there an employee contribution to your programs?
No.
It's just a benefit that's provided? And so you buy it from do you self-insure these
programs? We self-insure our programs, and we self-insure our programs specifically because we feel like it's more cost-effective for us, and because we don't want to have somebody, frankly, who has a motivation to turn down the claim, haggling with our employees about it when they're in a situation where they're dealing with something significant in their life.
So in a case like this, we've learned through just our proposal was 12 weeks. That includes short-term disability as well as family leave, both of which would be taxed differently, just the way they fall. And I guess under the tax code, I think the phrase is if it looks like unemployment, it's taxed this way. If it looks like workers' comp, it's taxed this way, which is fine. But the idea that you can offer these without cost to the employee, but you stop at 60%, is that, that has to be because
you
need to run a profit in life?
Yeah, I mean, you need to turn a profit in life, but in the same sense for us, we also are generous in terms of our vacation and our sick and personal time. So for a lot of our employees, they actually are getting 100% for a portion of it. But yes, I think that, again, if we were all able to, we would want to be taking care of people completely. And you look at economic realities and you do the best you can. But I feel like to give a state-paid FMLA program and say we're going to cover it at 60% is a little bit of an illusion, right? There's going to be 10 people who are bleeding, and you're going to give first aid to 5 of them because the other 5, even if there's things available aren't going to actually be able to utilize it. It's our lowest paid workers. It's the one who are going to be the least draw on the system are going to be the ones that aren't going to come to work if they're not getting 100% of their pay.
Representative, just to revisit what you had said about your experience with fraud, mm-hmm. when the administration was in here, they were sort of cautioning us about potential claims, and the chair sort of addressed that with Rhode Island. So if I gave you the figures that 40,000 claims were audited in Rhode Island, and of those 40,000 claims, they found 42 that were questionable, not mm-hmm. confirmed fraud, but only 42 that were questionable. Would that jive with your experience?
Absolutely. Like I said, people take pride in their work. People care about their coworkers. And they've already proven themselves to be a good employee by meeting that waiting period.
And one of the theories that we've heard over the years of working on paid sick days and on this program is that, and we saw it in the Rhode Island numbers, where they offer and pay for 30 weeks of short-term disability, only 4 weeks of family leave, but 30 weeks of, or 26 other weeks, I guess, of TDI. But the average usage is only 13%, and I think our modeling numbers are at a little bit higher rate. But still, is that? I mean, again, it's kind of the theory being that just because it's there doesn't mean it's going to get used.
I see employees. I mean, it came up yesterday. We had somebody go out with an eye surgery that was supposed to be out for a month, and they're coming out back after 10 days. And when I got the note saying they were coming back, I called them and said, I think this note is wrong because it doesn't match what you told me. And she was like, I'm recovering more quickly than people typically do from the surgery. The doctor told me he'd give me a note for a month, but I told him I'm good. You know, the reality is most people want to be at work. We very frequently offer benefits that people don't fully take advantage of. We offer 5 days of bereavement leave for deaths in immediate families. It's unusual for our employees to take more than 2 or 3 days. They go, oh my gosh, this is where I can let go of my stress and focus on something different. I don't want to be taking every day out of the workplace that I can.
And do you think that there's an attitude of like, well, if I only take three, then I have two left. Something might happen later.
There could be, and there should be. Yeah, there could be, and there should be. I mean, it is 12 weeks on a rolling calendar year, and you can run out if you are abusing it. And generally, I would assume that anybody that is abusing it, when I said that I've only seen twice in my years of HR, these were big and obvious. There's no, if you are somebody that doesn't want to be in the workplace and is trying to figure out what you can play for systems to be out of the workplace, you'll be able to do it for a little bit, but that pattern becomes really obvious. You're not going to have somebody whose morals and integrity means that they aren't taking advantage of things, all of a sudden decide they want to, and then immediately switch back to, okay, I'm going back to the status quo now because I've used up my 12 weeks.
So you're one of the businesses in the state that's over 20 employees.
Yep.
And we've heard, which is great because it's grown.
Yep.
You've doubled in size in the last 5 years, pretty much. What do you say to the people who, and we've heard, especially from people who have service industry, you know, work, not service industry jobs, but convenience stores and stores where there's low margins and you know, it's a different kind of workplace.
Yeah.
In your experience as an HR person, or in your, do you see that as an issue for those businesses?
I feel like the benefit to the state in attracting people would more than make up for what you're asking them to pay. A lot of the businesses that can't attract people are smaller businesses, are businesses that are paying at the minimum wage level. The cleaning company we contract with, we set you have to pay your people at least $15 an hour, and our cleaning company has trouble recruiting people. You know, the cleaners, the convenience stores, the restaurants, those are the places that if you go and look around, they always have help wanted signs. And the per employee cost is pretty low for the benefit of being able to fill things faster and have stronger employees in those roles.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and I believe Paul's coming in.
Paul is coming in, so you'll get to hear more from and about Chroma.
Great. Well, thank you for your time.
Thank
you. Doug, welcome back.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
And I understand we'll see you back again on another issue, so.
Yes.
Welcome to our committee. Well,
happy to be here. For the record, Doug Farnham, Policy Director for the Vermont Department of Taxes. So does the committee have any specific questions to start with, or should I just jump in to?
Yeah, why don't you just jump in? I mean, I think it's clear you were here for the first part of the conversation, and I don't want to pit tax versus labor, but we did last year. Or at least the Senate did. But the idea of what came out of the conversation this morning in relation to tax included, well, your systems are newer or more flexible, or you know, you offered to be able to take on a certain part of the dual maintenance of the, or administration of the system. So if you could just fill us in what your thinking is on that, and again, in a non-judgmental way, in just sort of an informational way, that would be great. Just to start, and then I'm sure we'll have questions to pepper you with. And you have to be in Ways and Means at 11:15?
I should be there to support my commissioner, yes, at 11:15.
Okay, so
he is technically in the chair. So
okay. We'll let you go by 11:25.
I don't want to misrepresent that. So, yes, for a little bit of context, the department recently replaced several legacy systems with, so we had an IBM mainframe, which was 40 years old. We had a Oracle database that was what I would classify as a failed implementation, as the person being hired by the department to come in and try to recover that system. That's how I ended up with the department about 7 years ago. That ended up being my first task. And we had a moderately successful kind of traditional state implementation of a piece of software that we customized to a certain extent, and it could do limited things, but we couldn't do much with it. It was very limited. So we had three systems, and over the course of 4 years, we spent about $30 million to replace that with a commercial off-the-shelf software that's used in 21 other states. And it's niche software. It's very focused on tax processing, so it does that extremely well, but it does have significant limitations if you try to do anything outside the realm of tax processing. So Cameron's points about if tax were to try to do the benefit side of this type of program, we have no experience with that. Our system isn't really designed to do that, so we would have significant challenges in trying to do that. But the specific question was asked of the department last year of, if you were to collect the money as a payroll tax with the payroll submissions, with the withholding forms, what would it cost to build? So I answered that question, and it is a fairly low number, only because we're modifying an existing system, and it's a manageable modification for us.
What was that?
I'd have to go back and look at it, but it was less than a couple million dollars. I think there were a couple different ranges I gave, but it was like, I think 500,000 to 2 million different points. I'd have to go back and look at the exact fiscal note, but it was for that collection, and that's our general range right now for putting in a smaller miscellaneous tax, smaller modification. It's going to cost us somewhere between $250,000 and $500,000 to update the system. For a bigger tax, it'll cost us a couple million dollars usually. But that's in the context of tax and only collecting the information necessary to calculate and charge a tax and then refund and recapture funds if necessary. What Cameron pointed out about tracking every employee, that was not in the model that we priced out. We priced out one field, basically, on the withholding form that would be a lump sum, and we would have no visibility into the individual with employees there. So the tax department would have no way of knowing until the end of the year, currently, when they file the annual reconciliation, how much each employee actually contributed. So for that real-time processing, the way we were talking about building it, the tax department would be of no help. in that situation.
So what would be the role then of what would be the role then of tax in, what would be the benefit to setting up any kind of system that's proposed in 107 of tax collect, you know, being able to collect those taxes, but with all the other information staying at labor? I mean, I think that's what Cameron was speaking of, is that
exactly.
Even if you peel off this small chunk of the collection so that you have a bank account of PFL money, that's essentially what you're saying, for the most part, that's what it would be.
Yes.
So what's the benefit to that, of taking that away from the labor side of it? I mean, do you do that for unemployment as well? Do you do that for any other labor-oriented taxes?
No, that's an extreme point of complication, is that tax only deals with the withholding definitions for what an employee is and who has to pay withholding. It's different for unemployment insurance. The universes largely overlap, but there are differences there that can be significant. And so there's a mismatch. And that mismatch is what would cause a lot of issues. With tax collecting the money, you could arrive at situations where it appears that someone should be due the benefit, but they weren't subject to the original payroll withholding. Because it's like a Venn diagram, the circles don't completely overlap.
So I guess we'll probably talk to Damien about this, but what is your understanding of it? I mean, we did talk about this earlier, about the fact that there are numerous definitions of employee in state yes. statute. What do you see as the two circles that create the Venn diagram?
Primarily the definition that we use for withholding, and then the definitions that's used for unemployment insurance, which I think most people have connected to the paid family leave concept, is the unemployment insurance definitions. And I think that's the way it was in the, yes, I believe that's the way it is in the bill currently. So if it were as structured, then tax, we would just be collecting the money and depositing it, just as we collect money and deposit it for use by A&R or transportation, and we don't talk to them at all about, you know, where that money came from generally.
So all of the policy, to open up the box on my paycheck, that's all you care about, is that box on my paycheck. You know, that nothing else really matters, like what actually happens to that money and how it's pushed out into benefits or stewarded is irrelevant to the tax department. It's just merely, along with these other taxes, that I'm collecting this percentage too.
Yes. And that was based on, I believe, mostly conversations in economic development, where I was asked to price out a model where tax is only involved on the front end and doesn't support really anything else there. Which makes it a quote of somewhat limited value, because, you know, when you try to actually make that work, how well does that actually work? I think labor would run into problems not having information that they need, because we took the information in a very blunt and limited manner.
Representative Clackie.
I was with you in the advisory board during the 4 years of the poll, and what was lovely to see is that it was stepped and you did components of it, but it also took a lot longer than we hoped it would, didn't it? I mean, what we're trying to figure out in the modeling is that there's like a one-year buildup for the IT stuff, and I'm just wondering in this bill if that's enough time, given your experience of it took 4 years.
So for the committee, I was two jobs ago at the tax department, I was the IT project director for the implementation of the system. And our system was on time. We had 37 tax types to put in, and we scheduled a certain number of tax types for each year. But we had about a year per phase, and that was with very little customization of code. So we weren't writing a lot of code. Most of the developers working on our project were configuration specialists. They didn't write actual code. They configured the attributes and the tables. So they weren't creating a piece of software. They were modifying it just for our purposes. And we agreed on behalf of the state of Vermont to dramatically limit how much we were going to customize that piece of software in order to reduce the risk of the project and meet those timelines and costs. So we made a lot of decisions to put things in a simple and streamlined way, where in the past, custom-built software, you tend to go down a lot of rabbit holes and, you know, build things exactly as they should be, whereas we built it in the most efficient way, all complying with the law, of course, but a very kind of minimalist approach to configuring the software, which I think if you want to avoid overspending, you know, you kind of have to do that nowadays. But
so you talked about buying off the shelf software, and I don't want to shortchange or actually give more credence to off the shelf software than perhaps I would like to. But I mean, is there a catalog of off the shelf software that I can look up and say, hey, look, it's paid family leave. You know, it's. You know, is there a source, and I appreciate the fact that, as you said, it's you purchased something that was very limited so that it could be efficient. But are there sources that are available in a commercial marketplace where you could at least start with? It sounded to me like labor was putting itself in a box where it had to almost create a whole new universe with this, or a parallel universe with unemployment.
I don't have any knowledge of any at the moment of any software packages that are designed specifically to do this. But I honestly haven't done a lot of research looking into that side of it. For context on the tax software, we had a somewhat difficult decision because when we went out for our RFP, we had three respondents essentially. Two of them were One of them really qualifies for what you'd think of as commercial off-the-shelf software, where it's used in many places, very little configuration is necessary. One was, they could technically meet the definition, but they were more, we're still building it and we'll make it work for your state. And then the third one was complete customization, you know, code build essentially. So with taxes, which all 50 states have to deal with in the federal government, there were only two or three options at this point. And that's for something that has been around for, you know, personal income tax 76 years or so, something like that. So I think it's, I don't know. Sorry.
No. We asked you to come in. I mean, we did. I mean, that was just kind of a, like I said, I don't. The less time I spend going, there must be an off-the-shelf kind of solution to this, isn't there? And, you know, it sounds like the answer is probably not. Not impossible, but probably not, at least not for a while.
Yeah.
Representative Clacky.
Or it costs $30 million over 4 years. Because you went with the firm that had this off-the-shelf thing that you then tweaked, right? Isn't that the firm you went with?
Yes.
So it still doesn't mean it's cheap off-the-shelf.
Right. Yeah. It was not the lowest cost options of the RFPs. We did choose to go with lower risk and quality over, you know, spending the lowest amount.
And did you get what you paid for?
Absolutely. The department's very happy. The way we paid for it was with, we tracked the benefits, the increased collections we were able to do with the newer system, and we actually paid off the contract for that. So that $30 million was an agreed fixed amount, but we paid it off more than a year early, I believe, ahead of when we anticipated being able to do that. And now we're working on proposals where the remainder of those benefits that we're collecting, the general fund and other funds will get a greater share. So at the end of the day, we believe we were successful in upgrading the software and producing more revenue for the state.
In your experience with just the IT in the state, I know you've been with the tax department, but we've heard a little bit about the fact that there might be different language or different, you know, that state departments don't necessarily easily speak to each other, or is that going to be a if this program goes forward, is that a problem?
I think it is getting to be less of a problem than it used to be. There are still some legacy systems out there with, you know, that require legacy code experience, but more of the projects started nowadays are going to be on SQL Server. Most new implementations we're seeing are using that. So I think the competition, and this is good and bad, the competition in language structures is completely different now than it was 10 or 15 years ago. There was a lot of diversity, and there's very little diversity, actually. Most people are training their developers primarily in Python and working in SQL Server, and it's kind of narrowing down. For the tax department is ironic because we, of course, don't allow our systems to actually directly interact with anyone else's for security reasons. But so we work through file interfaces where we have to. And then when you're working through a file interface, it doesn't matter what the original database is linked in. I do know that ADS for at least the next 5 or 10 years still has a tough job for them to maintain some of those legacy systems. But it is more in the keeping that database functioning properly and less in them talking to each other. But again, I'm speaking from an island, being in tax, we share very little of our data. We share when we're allowed to, but those are very specific exceptions.
From your department's perspective, the way that the administration is shared, is that the most efficient way to do this in the current bill we're looking at?
So, that's a very difficult question. I think that to speak outside of this bill for a moment, it really gets down to whether you feel like the state should be doing it or the state should be working through a third party, putting that responsibility on the third party. In general, I would say that if you have the systems to support it, one entity handling both parts matters and will be more administratively efficient. I think the fact that tax has a structure built right now that can be added onto to collect the money makes it very tempting to spend a small amount of money to just bring the money in the door. But because it matters so much to this particular program, who submitted that money, unless you're willing to accept wholesale that if someone was an employee, then they were submitting wages, then it could really complicate labor's administration of it. And again, listening to Cameron talk about unemployment insurance and the efforts they go through there, you know, we have 150 employees at the tax department to do all of the work related to 37 tax types. So we don't go into as deep of a dive as they do at labor, because we spread ourselves a bit thinner, so, I guess.
Did you have a follow-up? Sorry. So could there be a hybrid situation where, you know, we were in, the bill contemplates saying it's going to take a year to set up a system to collect the money, 15 months to collect the amount of money that we would want on the day we open the doors to the benefit. Is there a way to collect? I mean, from what I hear is that if you just simply collected the money, you could start collecting it just by opening up a box on a paycheck, and it wouldn't be your responsibility to follow who paid that money, but you would collect it. And then, but on the labor side, they would be able to know if I threw out my Social Security number, they'd be able to say, well, you made this much money this year, so I'm assuming you paid this much money into the, or perhaps it even shows that I paid this much money into the fund. But simply, I think we're going off of an income-based qualification. Mm-hmm. So is it possible that we could say, oh, let's let the tax department collect this money for 25 months and give labor 25 months before they have to have an up and running system to, and then take over that tax collection as they would for UI.
I think that that is certainly possible and
technically, not
yeah,
but technically.
Yes, because sometimes you do have to, especially if there do happen to be disagreements over how much a particular program is going to cost to administer, you may need to build a particular level of solvency in that fund in order to actually administer it, in order to actually, you know, budget and hire the people and spend the money on running it at that point. So you may
need to theoretically start up with a flexible program such as yours while labor is working out the kinks, especially if it's nothing else but collection.
Theoretically, because we're generally only involved in the upfront collection, I would think of it as how we deal with the clean water surcharge. The tax department collects the clean water surcharge and deposits it into that special fund. And then the Clean Water Board makes the decisions about how it is going to be spent, which projects it will be spent on. There's no, you know, absolutely direct link in the timing. Now, there haven't been mandated timelines as far as when those projects would have to occur. We're all just doing our best to meet the EPA's requests.
Right.
But yes, I would say that, you know, it depends on politically what's palatable to Vermonters, but yes, the department, in the limited version of the department's involvement in this bill, if we could stand up the additional collections through payroll relatively quickly and deposit those into a fund. And
okay. Fair enough.
Thank you.
All right, any further questions? Doug's got 5 minutes to get to Ways and Means. And
just downstairs, though.
Yeah, I think I can find it.
He's got to go put in like 2,000 steps.
Yeah, right.
So, any further questions for Doug?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll see you soon on alcohol taxes, I'm sure.
Yes.
So, thank you. All right, next witness is Paul Millman.
Hello, Paul. How are you?
Good.
It's good to see you.
Good morning.
Hi. Good morning. How are you?
I'm
okay. There was no ice on the road this morning. That was very nice.
That's good.
I appreciated that.
Yeah. We're going to go around circle and introduce ourselves to you. This is, it's been a little while since we've been at the committee, but that's irrelevant because so many of us are new. Either on the committee or into the legislature. So, Representative Tom Stevens from Waterbury, and sitting here but not today is Representative Deanna Gonzalez from Winooski.
Representative Matt Byron.
Randall Zott from Barnard.
Mariana Gamash from Swanton.
John Kalacki, now from South Burlington.
And Long Newfane.
Tommy Waltz from Berry City.
Nice to meet you all.
Okay. Chip Troyano from Standard.
Representative Marion Howard is from Rutland, and she is out today as well. And we have representative vacancy from Richford. So please come tell us.
Can I address representative vacancy?
You can.
That would be interesting.
He or she is the silent question.
Okay. I'll anticipate the question. I know you're running late, so I'm going to.
Actually, we're right on time. So
I'm going to be brief anyway. I hope. So in the vernacular of business these days, it's very popular to talk about risks and opportunities, and that's what this is about, I think. The risks in not having this bill passed are we don't make a new contribution to the Vermont workforce. People are encouraged to stay home because they have small children and they have no time off to deal with those children. The risks are we have a burned out workforce because who can work 52 weeks a year and only get weekends off? The risks are that we have that we promote illness in the workforce because people stay, continue to work instead of staying home when they're sick. And we know this, the potential of this is the measles epidemic that we're reading about. And so other communicable diseases, the flu, et cetera, those are the risks that among other risks that we see without having paid time off in the state, aside from the general moral conundrum that says, how do you expect people to work all of that time? This is going back to the pre-40-hour work week. This is going back to where we insisted that people work maximum number of hours except for that time that they're legally entitled to take off. The opportunities here is to contribute a small portion of what Vermont needs to a full-time workforce. The opportunities here for the state is to have a way of attracting new workers to the state. It's just one way of attracting new workers to the state. But a state that has a guaranteed paid time off is a state that offers something that other states don't offer. And people who work care about such things. The opportunity for the employer, because we all know that the bigger companies in the state all include paid time off, all include vacation time, all include health care in their employment packages. The opportunity for the smaller employers is that they can do it also. That they can offer to their employees what the larger companies offer now. Not as much, and I would love it to be more, but it's something. So the small employer can do it without it coming only out of their own pocket, because it's a pooled amount of money. So if I'm a small employer and I've got 5 employees and I don't have this, then I'm responsible for all of their paid time off. If we have this bill, then we are collectively responsible. And it's cheaper to be collectively responsible. We all know this. You know, this is in healthcare, this is in workman's comp, you know, this is in unemployment insurance. When you have a larger pool, the amount of money that the individual company pays is far less than if they try to do the right thing, and this is the right thing, if they try to do the right thing on their own. So I don't see that this is anything but a no-brainer. I see the plan that the governor and that guy from New Hampshire are proposing to not address risk and to not address opportunity. Because after all, if the individual workers are going to be responsible for paying the premiums and you make $10 an hour, then you don't get paid time off and you don't get health care, you get very little. It creates a very unhappy workforce, and we have an opportunity to contribute to developing a workforce that's proud to work in the state of Vermont. Thank you. But you know, I was going to say that.
Well, you can drop the microphone if you'd like. Questions for Paul. What I know of your work history is that you have worked anywhere between bartending and in restaurants and.
I was a busboy. I spent 11 years as a bartender and a waiter. I moved to Vermont, got a job, got fired, and started our own company, and that was 27 years ago. And I'm proud to say that we're one of the bigger employers in Windham County.
Well, and you settled. Why did you move to New Hampshire? Why didn't you go there?
It's not why did I not move to New Hampshire when I first moved to New England. The reason I moved to Vermont is because I had a cousin in Williamsville, and Vermont, as was printed in the Digger the other day, was filled with hippies, and I understood hippies, so I felt comfortable here. But it's later that I discovered the difference between Vermont and New Hampshire. We had a ribbon cutting of a, we doubled the size of our plant last year, and we had a ribbon cutting in November, and I was, when it came my turn to speak, I pointed out that the motto of the state of New Hampshire is live free and die. We in the South say live freeze and die. But the motto of the state of Vermont is freedom and unity. I mean, it's a no-brainer. Because what the motto of New Hampshire really does represent what New Hampshire is all about. And the motto of Vermont really does represent what Vermont is all about. And we can do it better even with legislation like this.
Representative Kalaki.
Your HR person gave us a lot of about your benefits, which seemed pretty extraordinary. But going from a startup, you started this, to this incredible now multinational corporation and one of the biggest employers in the state, like, what are the pressures for you in recruiting? From the higher level people to the entry level people.
So many of you know that in the summer we hired Janet Bombardier to become our chief technology officer. She still lives in what is that town over there? North of Burlington.
No.
Anyway.
Colchester.
Colchester. Okay. Sorry. She still lives.
I just struggle for those of us not from Chittenden County. Sorry.
I struggle with it because, just so you know, there's the Society of Professional Engineers just named Janet the Engineer of the Year. And so they sent us the press release, and they said, we will send it out to all the papers in the northern part of the state. We're nothing down there. I mean, not even the Society of Professional Engineers cares about our newspapers down there. Anyway, just an aside. Recruitment is difficult. Recruitment these days is more difficult than I ever imagined. When we started and as we were growing, it was fairly easy. We had a willing workforce in Wingland County, and we put out an ad and we got people. It's more difficult now. It's even more difficult for assembly workers. It's certainly very difficult to get engineers who are willing to live in the community. We have engineers that live outside the community. We have engineers that live in Burlington and work in Burlington. We have a subsidiary in Burlington. Our CFO commutes from Massachusetts. Janet commutes from Colchester. It's increasingly difficult in the southern part of the state to get workers. It's increasingly difficult outside of Chittenden County to recruit. It's not just the southern part of the state. You know, the kingdom has the same problem. Berlin has the same problem. You know, Barry has the same problem. And anything that we can do, that's among the reasons we have the benefit package that we have. Mostly we have the benefit package that we have because we think it's the right thing to do. But it also helps us recruit. And, everybody in the business community, in the state of Vermont, is talking about a dwindling workforce. Anything we can do to encourage young workers to move to the state is a benefit to the state. And as I say, this is one of those things. You know, rationalizing healthcare would be another one of those things. Affordable housing would be another one of those things. You know all these things. So, but this particular bill is one of the most important pieces of legislation, and it's uniquely brilliant because it doesn't ask the state to contribute, and it doesn't take money out of the public coffers. because it says, okay, we're going to make the vehicle for this to work. And then we're going to provide this to employers big and small. And like I said, it gives little employers the opportunity to act like big employers. And that's really important. When we were starting out, our company is a technology-based company. We put a small ad in Science, like this big, cost $6,000. And the next month, a new journal came out called Nature Genetics. And I could put a full-page ad in that journal for $1,000. For $1,000, we look like big shots. So it's important to give smaller companies the opportunity to act like big shots. And I think this bill does that. And frankly, I don't know any small employers in the state who don't want to provide services like this, benefits like this. I mean, some of the business organizations may tell you that they don't, but this is Vermont. Come on, guys. You know, our employers really do wish to provide benefits to their employees. Sometimes it's hard, so you're making it easier. Nice guys.
This, you belong to a number, or have belonged to a number of business organizations over
still
the years. And I mean, it's been a question for me. Sometimes, because this benefit is aimed towards those who have not had access to this before, lower middle class people, I believe the number this year is 100% wage replacement up to $55,000 a year, which is just about the median income in the state. But I wonder why some, do the large, in your opinion, do you think the larger organizations where their companies maybe as a rule offer this slew of benefits, do they not see that there's this problem at the lower end of the spectrum, the economic spectrum, or do they?
No, they do. I don't think none of the organizations, I can't say none of the organizations. The Vermont Business Roundtable has taken no position on this. I don't know what position the chamber has taken. I assume VBSR is supportive of it. I think there is throughout the business community, I can't talk for every organization, there's tremendous support right now for a related issue. The related issue is early childhood care and education. But it's a related issue, and so if the business community is in large part right behind that, you know, really in favor of universal early childhood care and education, and some of us also after school care for older people, older students, because same issues, actually more issues, one assumes that they would be supportive of this. I don't think we've asked them. It hasn't come up at any of the meetings that I've been to.
Right, they've adopted early childhood education as their as one of their solutions.
The Business Roundtable has, right?
Yeah, yes, for years now.
Yeah.
Big time now.
But why not on this issue?
It hasn't come up because we all have benefits. You know, none of us think, you know, none of us, but generally it's not what's in people's minds. You know, we know how early childhood affects us. We know that there's the potential of putting 11,000 more workers into the working population of Vermont if we have universal early childhood care and education. Nobody has seen this as a quantitative issue. You know, even now I'm talking about it as a qualitative issue. Once again, it's given the small business community an opportunity to provide the services and benefits that big businesses do, and I think they want to. And I don't know who's arguing against it. It makes no sense to me.
Well, we can offline provide you, I'm sure, with a list of
people. Tell them to call me.
So, but I think it's curious to me, because it's almost like we use the word privilege a lot in this world now, in this political world now, and we say, you know, is it the privilege of, well, I've always worked for a job that's always had these benefits, therefore everybody must have these benefits because I have them and I've always had them. I mean, I just wonder if there's a certain circle of, I don't know if it's blindness or blinders or...
Yeah, I'll tell you the truth. It never dawned upon me until Main Street Alliance started pushing for this proposal that people worked without vacation time. I never thought about it. It just never crossed my mind. When I was told it was true, it was completely unbelievable to me. I mean, I had, as they say, wrap your mind around these things. It's very difficult. You know, I can't imagine what it's like to spend 5 years at a job and have no time off other than weekends. I can't imagine spending 5 years at a job and not being able to stay home when your kid gets sick. You know, and surely if that's the case, you can't afford daycare. You know, these are things that are unimaginable to people in my position, and now we have been encouraged to imagine it.
Representative
Gamache. I'm interested if you have an idea of why. You mentioned a few times small businesses, they would love to do this. So since they're not doing it, and that's 78% of the state in terms of employers, what do you think is the reason that they're not doing it?
The issue is a complicated issue because it is expensive for a small business. You know, a coffee shop. You know, it is expensive for them to do it on their own. You don't do this. You don't give paid time off with insurance, right? It comes out of the profits of the business. So that's what's so beautiful about this. This is a group response to the issue. It is. You know, it's a very difficult question because it leads to this serious economic philosophic question, which is, if a business can't afford to benefit its most valuable commodity, the workers, then should it be in business? That's a bigger question. But I think it's a question that this country is going to ask at some point. You know, if I can't afford raw materials, I go out of business. But in a society where we place different values on workers than we do on raw materials, it's conceivable that you can low bid on workers and because you can't on raw materials, your supplier won't let you. So the supplier makes a constraint. The supplier limits your access to the supply. You know, the society will limit access to workers, you know, by hiring everybody, and then the small businesses are not going to have a choice. So but I understand, and I have sympathy for people who want to do the right thing, and I believe that. Well over 80% of Vermont businesses who can't afford it now would love to provide benefits. Mm-hmm. I have sympathy for them, and I think this is the first step in a creative solution to giving them that opportunity. This is a real opportunity.
Yeah, and I'll let you go in a minute. I mean, what we've heard just from individual folks who have managed to testify, in the past as well, is that, well, I do take care of it. I mean, you address this about being able to buy into a collective insurance program, you know, but I do take care of my employees. They are my lifeblood. They are, without them, I'm nothing.
It's just an interesting...
Well, why do they testify against the bill if they are? I mean, let's get real. You know, if they feel that it's important that they do it and they can afford to do it, why come in and testify against a bill that is going to make it easier and less expensive for them and other businesses? There's something else here. And I don't know what it is, but it flabbergasted me. Now, this happened during the healthcare debate years ago. You know, I want to provide healthcare for my employees, but I want the state to do it. You know, I will. You know, when one of my employees gets sick, I'll make sure that he or she gets paid. There's something about reliability. There's something about consistency. There's something about my being able to depend on the benefit that isn't answered by "I'll take care of them." And because once you have that opportunity, you can take care of some employees who you like, not the ones you don't like. You know, it's fraught with risk.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice to see you, Paul.
Good to see you. I hope to see you again. Soon. Not here.
Okay.
Let's have a little transition.
Oops.
Yeah.
I'm going to
stay. Welcome.
Thank you.
I think you missed our last round of introductions, so take a minute to introduce ourselves. It's a different committee from the last time you were here. Representative Tom Stevens from Waterbury, and we'll see you later this afternoon, so yeah. Make yourself at home. Representative Gonzalez from Winooski is unable to come in today, as is Representative Howard. They're both out under the weather.
Representative Matt Byrong, Sivan is a neighbor and a constituent of mine. We live on the same street.
Randall Todd Barnard.
Mariana Gamash, Swanton.
John Kalaki, South Burlington.
Emily Long, Newfane.
Tommy Waltz, Mary City.
Chip Troiano, Standard.
So, welcome. Please introduce yourself and where you're from and why you're here.
Great. Thank you for having me. And many of you I know, either from having been here in the past or from outside connections outside of the room. I'm the co-founder of Stonecutter Spirits. We're in Middlebury, and we have a bar restaurant in Burlington. We began as a company of two, just me and my business partner, and we are now 20 plus. We cycle between about 20 and 25 between the summer peak and the winter. And we've offered pay family leave since day one. So when we started the company and, you know, just wrote our employee handbook using a template from our legal firm and then trying to personalize it into our own language, we really spent a lot of time thinking through the kinds of things that an employer should offer to their employees, and to treat them like family for us involved treating them the way you'd want to be treated yourself. And so that wasn't just things that we wrote into our employee handbook, that was also the way we built our space. In our tasting room in Middlebury, we have skylights. The skylights are energy efficient. They also lead to better quality of life for those of us who work there every day, which is both us as the employers and for our team of employees. And they're better for our customers. And trying to think about things in a smart and thoughtful way that involved what would we want for ourselves, that's what you should want for the other people you care about too. And so that also included trying to be thoughtful about benefits to the extent that we could afford them. And we still are a small company. I mean, I feel massive now that we're 20 plus, but you know, in the grand scheme of things, that is still just a small bite out of the apple. And we offered family leave because it was the kind of thing that we thought would be right for people. What we found in the 5 years since is that it has also been a wonderful recruiting tool. And so in an industry like ours, you know, Stonecutter Spirits, we make gin and whiskey. We're a young industry where, you know, I'm one of the older people in our industry because I'm in my mid to late 30s, is not an industry that is as spread out in age demographics as others. And that age set is one where Vermont as a state, as we all know, has been struggling most significantly. We're losing younger folks, we're not retaining ones who come here, and we're not attracting ones to come here in the first place. And we found that offering benefits like family leave ended up being a differentiator that helped us hire and keep people. And we've ended up having folks come to work for us, either folks who are Vermonters who grew up and stayed here, or folks who came to Vermont for school and then chose to stay here when they found exciting jobs with companies like ours. And that includes former students from Champlain College, UVM, St. Mike's, and Middlebury College. All those are real examples of folks that came to school here, either having grown up here or having come here for school and stayed and worked with us. We've been asked many times, well, if you already offer family leave, why would you support other folks offering it? That's going to take away one of your competitive advantages. And we found that to be quite the opposite of the case, because what we do find as a challenge, and this is one that I believe was asked of Paul before me, is recruitment in general and the pool of potential applicants. And as compelling as one can be in the benefits that you offer, if there aren't enough folks here in the first place to be interested, there's still a shortage of potential people who are right for the job or qualified or interested and looking. And one of the biggest factors in whether or not you're gonna have that pool is people who are already here. Right? We're not a large employer. We don't offer some of the much larger, more generous benefits that were discussed, although we do offer family leave, we offer vacation, we offer, you know, sick time. People aren't going to move to Vermont to come work for us. And they're not going to move to Vermont to come work for most other small businesses. Some of the larger employers can have enough in terms of benefits, in terms of being able to pay for your move, other things like that, where they can really bring folks in from out of state who come here. But most of the rest of us are trying to find qualified applicants who are interested in working for us who are already here. And it's great if we happen to offer this benefit, but the real advantage to us and to other small businesses would be if everyone's offering the benefit. Because if you have a state where this is just a statewide benefit, I think you have a much greater chance of having a lot of folks who are coming here and settling here who are in that younger demographic where they're more likely to either be already having kids or planning on having kids. And obviously family leave is more than just children, but that's one of the biggest and most salient parts. And it gives a chance for folks to think about, where do I want to actually put down roots? Here's a place where I could come and start a family or grow a family. And here's a place where I could grow old and care for my parents as they get to the point that they need extra help. Things like that are important. And if we can offer them in a larger pool, that isn't taking away our competitive advantage. It's giving us a new one. Also, related to that, I've always found it fascinating from economics. There's a lot of research that supports that. I'm a former research scientist myself, so I get very interested in this stuff. But if you had a hot dog cart in the corner and another hot dog cart comes and joins on the corner, you'd think that the natural reaction should be, hey, get off my corner, you're competing for my business. But there's a ton of economic research that has shown that if the second hot dog cart comes, they actually both end up doing better. Because more folks now know it's a place that you can go to get hot dogs, and that's what they start thinking about on their lunch break or whatever, wherever you carry the analogy. And we've seen that in a ton of real large examples. You think about the Flower District in New York and all these places where a block is known for something. Now, how can you have all these things that specialize in this thing all doing well, but once people know that's a place to come, that actually leads to a much larger set of folks to come there. And that's what we want here in Vermont. We want this to be a place where young people are choosing to come and settle, where young people who are growing up here are staying, where young people who grew up here and went somewhere else for school or for another job come back when they're ready to settle down. Those are the things that we all want, that we're fighting for. And, you know, Paul spoke earlier, I don't know how some of the small businesses think. I could speak to how some of the small businesses think, because that is who we are and that's who our peer set is. And we all talk about these things. Not all of us can afford to offer some of them. Speaking to that as a last point, and then I'll just open to questions. We are a small business that is not profitable. We're growing, we're investing in ourselves, we're trying to grow to the point that we can be what we really want to be when we grow up. And so when we make choices about things that we're spending on, every one of those is a dear choice, because we're not even break-even yet. We're growing every year. It's a wonderful trajectory, but all that is only because we've had great financial backing from our lenders and from our financial backers who've helped us grow to this point and continue to do so. So when we think about benefits like these, they are expensive. And when you really think about something like family leave being an insurance program, we're an employer who employs mostly younger folks as the age representative goes, as the age demographic goes, that means we're more likely to have folks who are going to need these services. It also means that if and when that happens, we're in a much harder position to be able to cover a person's workload for a couple months while they're out. We believe they should be able to be out, but we don't have the ability internally to spread our risk the way a larger employer does. An employer that has 150 people and is able to offer these same benefits also knows that on average, it's gonna spread out over time. Even if they weren't profitable, but especially a profitable company, they can build that into their budget and be able to spread out when the hits happen and you're essentially double paying for one person's work for a couple months because you have to bring someone else in or you have to add some extra hours to other folks to help cover. A larger company can spread that risk out internally. Small companies like us can't. And so we are just suddenly at the risk that if and when someone is fortunate to be able to say, hey, looks like we're going to have a kid, or hey, we're adopting a kid, or any of the other things that are wonderful, we want to support that. It also means we have to figure out how to cover that when they're out. And that's really hard for a small business. I think it's one of the main reasons that other folks that are our peers don't offer these benefits, even if they want to. A statewide plan like this actually spreads out that risk, and that is such music to the ears of a small business person when there are so many other unforeseen things that happen all the time that we don't know in the first place what we're going to see. So any of those question marks that we can take away are always fantastic.
So you say you already have a paid family leave program. How does that work for you? How do you pay into that?
Yeah, so we don't pay into anything. We promise our employees that we're going to cover them if they're out. And so we offer all employees, this is the structure for full-time, part-time is similar, it's just proportional. Full-time employees, if you have a child or you adopt a child, if you're a mom or a dad, please take 2 months off, fully paid, and then when you come back, please come back for the next 2 months, only half-time, so that you still have a chance, even while you're zoning back into work, to spend a lot of extra time at home with the newborn or with the new adoptee. But to your question, we don't have our own internal pool where we put money aside every month for this or that. It's just a financial risk we will have to bear if and when they happen. And that's really scary for a business. So, you know, we could also alternatively put money away in a certain proportional thing and be our own insurance policy. But even that is very difficult as a small company. You don't have a company big enough to print out real actuarial tables and know what it would be. So even if you're putting money in a special savings account for that, you would still not have great confidence that's accurate.
And just to follow up for Representative Sharma, just the, so the idea, and Mr. Millman said this, is that so you're paying full freight. I mean, we've heard this from some small businesses as well. You're paying full freight, basically, if I have to take 6 weeks off.
Absolutely.
And that's, on one hand, that's normal. I mean, you're just not getting compensated. You're not getting compensated by my work. Have you done the math yet on what it would cost your business now? I mean, you've graduated now. You're in the top 10% of businesses in the state of Vermont in terms of employees. Have you done the math on what it would cost you on an insurance program like a paid family leave program like this, or specifically this one, as opposed to what it would cost the occasional employee?
Yeah, I think that we would save money in the long run. If I was speaking cynically, I would say we haven't yet had folks who've called on us for the benefit, so anything that we pay is going to cost us more. But I'm not a cynic in that way, right? This is a benefit that we offer because we want folks to utilize it. And as our young workforce that is more heavily in their 20s than their 30s grow, we want them to stay with us and grow. So we want this to be something that is more likely to be drawn upon soon. And in the long run, I think that we save money. At the very least, even if we didn't, I know that it spreads out the risk, and that alone is worth it.
Well, it's exactly that. Representative Trinell.
Well, that was more or less what I was going to ask. If a consistent contribution from your business would be a more sound method of this approach to provide family leave, is that something that you considered or would support?
I think the biggest part for us is thinking about a proper insurance plan that has a large enough pool, right? And so if you think of this like a real insurance plan,
sure.
I really appreciate the thoughtfulness that's gone into making this about more than just a certain age set that are having kids, right? One of the big fatal pitfalls, I think, of Governor Scott's plan is a voluntary plan. you're most likely to volunteer in if you think something is going to be relevant to your life. And by having the current plan cover more than just birth of children, but also, you know, caregiving, that you really have a compelling and meaningful reason why it should apply to all the working population of Vermont. And when you have it applying to all the working population of Vermont, not just do you have larger numbers, but you have a much more diverse set of life circumstances, right? People at different points in age, and, you know, people are having children later and later in life now than they ever used to as well. So some of the classical or you know, the stereotypical versions of what these would apply for change. But to have that large set, I think, ends up being much more meaningful. I actually do think that's a cost reduction for all of us, rather than if we just did it ourselves. Also, to Governor Scott's plan, there's been a lot of hand-wringing I've heard, or maybe this is supposed to be the good spear that says, well, hey, if you do a state-funded plan, you wouldn't be eligible for the federal credit to employer, the new federal credit that's offered to employers that offer family leave. But that credit is not all it's cracked up to be, and I don't think that gets enough airtime of why it's not actually as helpful to businesses like ours, because it's a non-refundable tax credit. And so, you know, to go back to the fundamentals of tax credits and deductions, right? But a credit, in theory, is worth more than a deduction, but only if you can use it. And credits are broken out into non-refundable tax credits and refundable tax credits. And a refundable tax credit, you'll get the money regardless. Non-refundable tax credit, you'll only get it if you're profitable enough to use the amount of the tax credit. So you take a small business like ours, who is not yet profitable, we could offer $1 billion in family leave. The credit we will get from that federal credit is zero because we are not profitable. We don't have income, net income, against which to take it because we are still a growing business that's not yet profitable. And now forget a business like us that's 20 and is fortunate to be able to build loans and financial backers who can help us spend more than we make every year because we're trying to grow to the level of what we spend at. Take a normal small business in Vermont, right? I mean, oftentimes small businesses and startups are lumped into the same category, but there is a very logical difference, right? Most businesses are small businesses, they're not startups. They're not trying to grow to be a 50-person company. They're not they're trying to be a small business with a team of 5 or 10 people who do the thing they do. When we think about our Main Street businesses, those are classic small businesses, and that's a big fabric of who we are as towns and as a state. And so many of those small businesses, even if they are not in a loss position every year, if they're just break even, right? Well, then they don't necessarily have the capacity to take a non-refundable tax credit. So there's a lot of, you know, hand-wringing and saying, well, you know, you have to do the governance plan because you could retain the use of this credit. If you do the legislative plan, then you wouldn't. That credit is really only worth something to profitable companies. So you're continuing to build a divide between the haves and the have-nots, not in terms of the employees, in terms of the employers. Larger profitable companies, they'll be able to utilize that credit. Many of the small businesses and startups in Vermont won't be able to.
Answered all my questions. Yes?
Well, I don't mean this to be an inappropriate question, truly, so I'm not sure how to. I'm curious. You're not breaking even. So, should you have an employee or two, unexpectedly, need to have a block of time off,
mm-hmm.
and you don't have reserves for that specific, how will you manage? I don't want to say you're running your business in a deficit, because I don't know that. So I'm not about to make that statement. But having been a small business owner myself, that's a kind of a tricky thing.
Absolutely.
So you must have very generous lenders and people who are involved financially in your business.
Happy to speak to that. I could talk real numbers with you, not in testimony of the record, but just without even using numbers.
No, I don't want you to use
numbers. I'm saying I wouldn't be afraid to talk about numbers, right? Mm-hmm. So as a growing business who has been fortunate to grow, you know, we grew 50% year over year last year, mm-hmm. 70% the year before. You know, we're really work on it. We're pushing hard. The rubric in the world of startups to try to grow that way is typically some version of spend this year what you want to make next year so that you can grow to that level. You can only do that if you have sufficient reserves.
Yes.
And you're absolutely right, but the only reason we can do that, not even because of our lenders, the lenders were the original part that helped us grow in, and the lenders have backed equipment, things like that, but the rest needs to come from investors, and that has to be folks who believe in the long-term vision of the plan, because they are funding that gap every year. And you can't run that gap forever, but to try to do this right, you run that gap in the early years, so that you can be spending this year what you want to make next year so you can catch up to that. And over time, those come closer and closer.
Oh, yeah.
We think we're 2 years away from really being able to cross that. And that's only because we've had folks who believe in the vision over time. So yes, we are keeping reserves, not because we're profitable enough to make the reserves ourselves. Those reserves come from the folks who've chosen to back us and have put money in up front.
Representative Byron.
Given the need to run, close that gap, you need to obviously keep experienced employees. What's your turnover rate look like?
Yeah, so
your employee growth, and you know, kind of apply that all.
Yeah, I would say there are two halves of the business that really end up speaking to the two locations, right? Our production facility in Middlebury, which is also our headquarters, that's where we're based out of, that's where sales efforts are based out of, and our bar and restaurant in Burlington, which is more of a classic bar restaurant. That part of the business has much more turnover simply because that's classic to the industry, where you have folks who are hourly and they work shifts, and many of them are not full-time. You know, they have 2 days a week, and that's cobbled together as part of, you know, they're also in school, they're also working a different job, and so that certainly has higher turnover. In the business in Middlebury, which is our production and sales, we've actually really been blessed with very low turnover over the years. Most folks who are with us now have been with us for 2 years or more. We've had very few times that we had to let someone go. The times where someone left, it was usually for their own personal reasons or life changes, or they're leaving the state or other things like that. So we've actually had remarkably low turnover, and I think that's because we have the right fabric of what employees would find desirable, what they're looking for. And I think we've been really fortunate in the spirits industry, the alcohol industry in general, certainly one of the bellwethers of an exciting industry that folks want to come and be involved in. But also beyond that, I think it's because small companies like ours that are growing offer a lot of opportunity to employees in terms of what do you do day to day? What is your actual job? Is there room for it to grow? And, you know, in a larger, more classic corporate hierarchy, the way you grow is you eventually, you know, move up to the next level within your hierarchy because your boss got promoted, and then you get promoted to take your boss's spot. And, you know, that kind of classic growth is great for someone who's specialized in studying XYZ in school, and then they go to work in a job like that. And, you know, smaller employers, we don't have things like that often. But what we do have, in the case at least of startups or growing companies, is we always have more things coming on. We're always expanding into a new thing, or we're doing more of the last thing we did, or, oh, we have to now do that. Anyone know how to do that? Who at least wants to be the one that figures out how we do that? And that is actually remarkably exciting to employees who feel that they get the chance to grow with the role.
We like to say, not only do we want young people to move to the state, but we like to say, jobs, jobs, jobs. And I get to hear, at least at this level, I'm sure Commerce hears it as well, what are good jobs? You know, I mean, we hear that there's a shortage of engineers, there's a shortage of this, there's a shortage, you know, we hear about the flaws, the lack of, you know, the lack of employees for certain things, but, you know, sometimes a job is just a job. And people may not, whether it's a brewery or a distillery or any of the other jobs that you talked about, what makes a good job, not only to you, I mean, you're a business owner, you're an entrepreneur, but for the people who work for you, what's a good job? When I say we support good jobs in this state, what am I talking about anymore?
Yeah, I think that without speaking to specific industries, a good job is one that you want to spend your time doing. You know, with the two things that we spend most of our time on is sleeping and working, right? And then we only get a sliver of time left to actually do the other things that we think of as what defines our life, whether that's our family or our hobbies or our, you know, other pursuits. And so work, I think, to be meaningful should be things that you believe in doing and people with whom you believe in doing those things. And so I think what we've seen as employer, and also what I've seen personally in my career throughout the years, is the places that were meaningful to work were the ones where you weren't constantly looking at your watch waiting for the chance to get out of. Not saying that we don't need to all stress hard working really well to keep a good work-life balance. Even we as employers have to remind ourselves and recommit often to our employees, we're not going to text you at 11 p.m. We're not, you know, we want to keep those divisions and give you the chance to have your time away. But the ones that are meaningful are the ones where you're excited about what you're doing and you love the people that you're doing it with. And that involves the environment that the employer can build. And a lot of those come back to these benefits.
And our role as legislators who like to say we need to have more jobs, what's appealing to you? I mean, is it this program? Is it, I mean, again, it could be taxes, it could be zoning, it could be,
Yeah, I mean, without going into alcohol-specific things, that's specific to our industry, in general, for Vermont, it's benefits like this. It's specifically availability of childcare. Not only a method with which to pay for it, but literally just availability. The slots aren't even sufficient enough if you could afford it. So we need to figure out how to get more slots, and we need to figure out how to help folks pay for it. And it's health insurance. Health insurance is, I mean, we all know that's been a big issue in Vermont for a long time, but that's one of the biggest ones for those of us who are small, that we can't really offer a way to help folks other than just saying, hey, go be on the exchange and you'll get something better or cheaper on the exchange for where you are in your income bracket or at least whatever, then we could offer. Or that's a really disappointing answer to give to employees, and it is one that hurts recruiting. You know, the last one is one that I personally am just excited about, which I think is much smaller, but is retirement. And I am involved on Treasurer Pierce's board for the Vermont Secure Retirement Board, which we're really excited to create that program. I think, you know, I've tried to create a 401k, small business 401k at the previous employer where I was the number two. I was the COO and CFO. And I've tried to, didn't really actively try at Stonecutter, which is started because I've already been through the process. As someone who used to work in finance and knows how to read the numbers, the costs in retirement plans for small businesses is so offensively high that either it's bleeding away any actual chance for your employees to save, or the employer has to kick in more to cover that. And that's just, it's almost usury what the financial firms try to charge a small business of 10 people or 20 people. So, you know, those directions that we're all going in, a statewide plan for a small business retirement plan, statewide plan for paid family leave, hopefully some more progress on childcare. Those are the things we need to make this a more compelling state to have and keep people, and to be the kind of place where people are more likely to love their jobs in the first place, because whether the jobs chose to offer it or not, they suddenly start having these things. And, you know, how challenging is it when you just had a kid to still be working, whether they wanted to give you the time off or not? It's hard to go back to work, right? Or even the other little things. You know, our approach and policy to sick leave is just take it. There's a number of days. It doesn't take away from your vacation. If you're sick, don't come in the office and get everyone else sick. Let us know. Don't abuse the policy. Keep us posted. If you can work from home or be available from home while you're home on the couch, please do so. Don't let things languish. Let us know things you need covered. But I think those approaches are really meaningful to employees. You know, the trust that comes along with that, and the logic of saying, we don't want you to be here when you're sick and you're going to be half effective. You're not going to want to be here. It's going to make you resent your job, and you're then also likely to get everyone else in the office sick. That's just not something we should encourage. And we don't want to give you time off to be away from that, but it's time off you have to choose. Should I use it as vacation or should I use it as sick time? You know, combined PTO is often called. We don't like that approach either, because we don't want you to be hesitant to eat. Well, am I sick enough? No, I just kind of got a cold. I'll just go and cough on everyone and all the handles. But that's right. To be places that offer that meaningful response to employees, I think gives them a chance to really buy into what they're spending their time doing every day. And that's what we all want, both for more jobs, for the jobs themselves to be more meaningful, and for the employers who are creating them to have employees who want to be there, which therefore makes it easier for us to do what we're doing, and hopefully for more employers to come and create more jobs.
Last question, it's after 12. Last question is very quickly. Do you pay more in healthcare insurance for your employees or property taxes?
Well, we don't pay for health insurance for our employees. And we don't directly pay the property taxes since we rent both our locations, but it's passed through, so way more in property taxes in this case.
In this case?
Indirectly.
Because you're not paying for the insurance.
Correct.
Right. Okay. All right, committee, thank you.